Can someone tell me what is Great Search CV that we started discussing it from? Okay, so anyone? Darshana? Hello? Everyone is on mute. Okay, I'll tell. Okay. So we said that what usually happens is because the number of hyperparameters, or for that matter, number of parameters are so much in number, right? It is very tough to keep a track of those things at any point, okay? Manually, basically, right? So for that reason, SKLearn has given a device called Great Search CV. This is a function which will take as many parameters as you can pass, right? And then it will try out different combinations out of those and will give you a combination which is the best out of the lot. Got this point?
Yes.
Right. Now that is what I said. Now if I have to just give an introduction of Great Search CV, this is nothing but the member of model selection, right? Model selection package from SKLearn. Now this fits to the hyperparameter and fits on the estimator on your training set, basically, right? So you're training your model, right? So which is, what is the best, you can say, at which particular parameter, let's say I'm talking about max depth, at which depth my accuracy is better, right? What is the maximum number of leaf nodes? What should I set the maximum number of leaf nodes? Should it be 8? Should it be 10? Should it be 12? How would I know? I have to keep a track of the error. I have to keep a track of the accuracy. Yes or no? For all the combination. Manually, it becomes very tough. And that is the reason Great Search CV comes to us for SQ, right? We are going to do manually also. But Great Search CV makes things easier for us. And it helps you to try out many more things, which manually it is very, very challenging. Okay. Right. Now, what is the aim? What is the aim? You can select. So you can select basically the best parameters. From the listed parameters, or I'm just writing hyperparameters. Correct? You understand? Now, think it something like, for example, again, I'm repeating the same thing. What Great Search CV does, I'm just giving a class full of students, right? And Great Search CV is returning me the best students, right? And it is using best team, basically, right? So for example, there is a school in which there are 500 people, right? I'm giving this to Great Search CV, right? And it is giving me, I just want a team, right? Team of, let's say, whatever, 11 people, best 11, right? With a combination. So let's say there are, wicket keepers, right? So let's say there are, out of 500, there are 50 wicket keepers, right? Batsmen, we have like 400 or 300, right? Bowler, we have, let's say, 100, right? And like that, what else? All-rounder, right? All-rounder, we have 50, correct? Like that. So out of these list of 50, this 300, this, what is the best combination, right? What is the best combination that Great Search CV will return? So I'll pass all those people to Great Search CV, and Great Search CV will give me the best possible combination. The only difference is that here in example, it can take multiple, in wicket keeper, it will take one, but bowler, batsman and bowler, it can take multiple, yes or no? Correct? So yes. That is actually not happening in the real life. But just to understand, you can think like how the wicket keeper is selected. Out of 50, we have to select how many?
One.
Right? And it has to be the best combination, right? It has to be a combination with the bowler also. Let's say if someone is, some wicket keeper is good with spin, right? And someone is good with pace bowler. I'm just giving an example, right? So if I'm picking out the fast bowler, right? Then I have to pick that particular wicket keeper. So there should be a combination, right? Not only the best out of the lot only for wicket keeper, but we have to also see which bowler, right, it is doing. Similarly, if the wicket keeper, let's say, is defensive, right, very defensive, and we are playing 20-20, right, we would rather not select them, right? We want someone who can, fire out in the middle, right? So we need that particular. So we need to see the perspective and what is required, and based on that, I can select. So we cannot say that the batsman we have selected is the best out of it, but yes, that is the best combination. Got my point? Individually, he or she may not be best, but it is the best in the combination. The combination is best. You got my point? Yes, no?
Yeah.
Okay. So that is what Great Search CV does. Now just repeating the thing. Why needed? I have already told, but still I'm writing. Why needed? Why is it needed?
Because it's difficult to handle all the
parameters.
To get the best combination out of the data.
See, getting the best can be done manually also. So what is the advantage, right? So manual selection of parameters, or for that meter, you can write the parameter as hyperparameter. So hyperparameters are complex and very time consuming. Right? Another disadvantage with having manual method is hard to keep a track, right? Keep a track of the hyperparameters. You understand? So I'll tell you what I mean. That we have tried, right? We have tried. Correct? And let's say still have to try. So for example, let's say I have to select one wicket keeper, one batsman, one bowler, and one all-rounder instead of 11, right? Now, out of 50, I have, let's say, Rishabh Pant, right? Or who else? Dinesh Karthik or something like that. Who else were there? MS Dhoni and multiple more, right? Similarly, batsmen, let's say I have N number of batsmen, Rohit Sharma, Virat Kohli, right? Other Chiteshwar Pujara, all those people, right? And then we have bowler, right? Bumrah, Shami, then Shiraz, something like that. So we have multiple bowler. So like that. And all under we have, let's say, Ashwin or Jadeja or XYZ, whoever you say, right? For example, now what I can see, I have tried with the combination of, let's say, I have taken Rishabh Pant. In batsman, I have taken, let's say, Virat Kohli. In the bowler, I have taken, let's say, Bhuvneshwar Kumar. And in all-rounder, I have taken Jadeja. So this is my first combination. Yes or no?
Yes.
This is my first combination. So I have to keep a track. This combination, so all those four parameters that I tried, let's say A, B, C, and D. What is the accuracy? What is the other things, right? With relation to this fourth choice I have made. Similarly, I can have other choice. With, I can change only one and then use all the three same, or I change all the four, right? You understand? There are different permutation and combination. It is very tough to keep a track of all those things manually. Correct? You understand the difficulty we can face?
Yes.
Right? So that is where, grid search comes to us to rescue. Okay? Right? That is about the theory mostly, right, of our decision tree and random forest. Okay, you got an idea of how the split is being done. I'm just repeating for you, right? What is first of all a decision tree? Why is it called a tree? Why is it called a decision tree? Because a decision is made. What are the terminologies that we use, right? What are the different terminologies that we use at each point, right? What are the splits, right? Different splits we have gone in depth, right? Used one, only one example to explain all. If I had to use different examples, you would not have been able to relate, right? So that we did. After that, we went ahead and saw that how bagging and boosting works, correct? After that, what we did? We explained, right? We explained about the weak learner, strong learner, what is random sampling with replacement in random forest, right? Clear? Or in other words, it is also called bootstrap aggregation, correct? Now, after that, we said that since there are multiple trees, single tree has to be treated like we did in the decision tree, correct? So single tree is decision tree. Only how many trees we have to grow, that is in our hand. In one tree, what should be the maximum depth? All those things, hyperparameters, we have seen, correct? And we have categorized it into two. One is model's complexity, speed, right? Prediction power and speed. That is in two ways we have discussed. And both the things are kind of contrary to each other. If you want more speed, obviously you need your model to be lighter. In some cases, it can be like, sometimes you will come and say that this is giving a better result without being heavier. Thus, yes, that can be, that can happen. But for your understanding, I have divided it into two parts, right? You can use a combination from both, right? But you have understood. After that, I said that yes, now we have the hyperparameters. We can do it manually, right? We can do it manually, and then we are going to do it manually also. But in addition to do manually, because in real life scenario, you won't be doing manually, right? You need some device which can train multiple hyperparameters just by one, just to pass all the hyperparameters and it do the thing, okay? So that is where this grid search cross validation or grid search CV comes to us. Clear? Why is it called cross validation? Anyone? Can anyone explain? Or try to explain at least. And this has nothing to do with what we have learned. Just think in the terms of cross validation and grid search CV as a concept and try to explain.
Cross validation is like searching.
No. Why grid search CV is called cross validation?
Okay. In that way, like it's getting one combination and checking with other combination and giving the best combination out of.
Correct. So basically, if you just subdivide the term cross and validation, so cross validation is nothing but you're using one at a time, right? Cross validation, and then you are validating it. Validating means you are looking at the result, and then you are deciding with respect to result. You got my point?
The decision, how it is made, can you explain it? Like the decision will be done by the grid search CV only, or we have to take the decision?
So yes, we are coming to that. I have already told, based on the accuracy, it will take the decision, right? Better, best accuracy, whichever combination it will give, it will pass that. Okay. Once I'll show the code, you would be able to understand. Okay. Understood. So any other question? So this and document is, I think where we have explained the bagging, boosting and hyperparameter, right? Hyperparameter tuning and, cool. Now let me go for the code. Okay. You have to be concentrated here. Okay. I'm going for the code. So importing libraries, you all know, right? All the pre-processing and sklearn libraries are imported. So the decision tree classifier is in sklearn's tree algorithm, because decision tree is usually called a tree algorithm, okay? And after that, all the things, confusion matrix, accuracy score, right? All those things. Now, SVM, why I have done is because I was trying SVM at some point of time on this notebook only. You can avoid this because we haven't studied SVM, right? I was trying to see what is the, what is in with respect to SVM, how is it performing, right? So that is. So except that there are multiple things which, like GraphWiz, I used this long ago to show the tree diagram. So I'm just going ahead and I'm just showing you. So using GraphWiz, you can actually see how the tree is splitting at each node, and at each node you can see what is the genie. Correct? You understand? Or in that case, for now it is genie by default. Okay, but you can see other splitting criteria also. Got my point? So importing libraries, you can figure out. Reading file. So again, this thing, I'm coming to the data part. So this data is basically the bank data. Okay. Now it tells each row represents a person, right? With its age, his or her job, marital status, education, has any default. So we are talking about, since it is a bank data, we are talking about the loans, right? Has there any default in his, is there any default in the EMI that you are paying, right? That is what it means. Balance, how much balance, right? Housing, right? Yes. Loan, any other loan? No. Contact, let's say someone is giving their phone number. So usually those things, email ID, phone number, contact, right? Day, right? It tells, it tells about what is the day and month when a particular loan was taken. Okay, what is the duration, right? What is the duration in days? Okay, campaign, right? And P days, we don't know what these things are, right? So let's perceive it as it is. I know, right? I know what these things are, but I'm just saying, I'm just training you guys to understand that it's okay if you don't know any particular column. You understand? So I'll be coming to that. I'll explain also what are these things, but for now, just think in this term, that what if at any point in any data set, we don't know any particular column, right? This is P outcome and this is deposit, whether a deposit he has done or not, right? Clear?
Dhruv, can you explain the P days and previous?
I'll be coming to that. I said, I'm training you guys to understand this, that if, let's say, if a data set has 80 columns, right? 80 columns. It is okay if you don't know about 5 or 6 columns.
Okay.
Correct? Now, in any data set, if you're not a domain expert, or for that matter, like, for example, I'll give you a very real example, right? When I was working with retail, right? Anyone from retail here?
Me.
Okay. You might be knowing what is CLTV.
No, I mean, I'm working in bank.
Okay. So yeah. See, this was one of the, columns which I got. Okay. And no one in my team was actually knowing what is CLTV. See, this is how they write. So P days, like for example, I'm going to explain, but let's say you, at some point, you get, let's say P days or CLTV, right? Or previous. See, if we go and without looking at the data dictionary, you won't be knowing that. And usually in real life data set, in Kaggle, you get the data dictionary, right? But in real life, you are not getting, what is the data dictionary? Okay, so then what will you do? Anyone?
Go to business person.
You can ask manager.
How will you manage? Maybe, okay. So you are thinking that, Dhruv, that might not be important, but I'm saying that might be important also. How will you do?
Go to domain expert.
You can ask the manager domain of the expert. Team
No, domain expert, it's fine. Okay. Some of the things even domain experts are not known. Because see, this data set, let's say a table is created by, or for that matter, a column of a CSV is written by someone like you and me, correct? Yes. He may write something which is not visible to you and you are not able to contact him or her, right? Then what will you do? What is the thing that can be done? Tell me. This CLTV was nothing but customer lifetime value. Does anyone know what is this customer lifetime value? Sometimes it is called CTV also, or LTV also. LTV usually it is called. Okay. So my purpose of telling you is, understand this. Whenever we are going for a data set, right? Whenever we are going for a data set, then we have to understand this, that not always, right? Not always we will get to understand each and every column. So we have to be ready with it, right? Understood? But it remains unanswered. What will you do? I just want to know the approach. It's fine even if you are not knowing anything in this particular prospect. But tell me honestly, I just want to understand, what will you do? How will you overcome this difficulty?
Web search, try to search something on web and see if I could get some information.
That is one way. What else?
Contact relevant people who are working in this field, if you have any friends or contacts.
Correlate with the data that we actually know, how it is correlating or how important is the data.
Correct. This is, yes. Now, see, sometimes usually what happens is a particular column is nothing but a combination of and different things, right? And different things. And then and that is where we are talking in the terms of its predictability. See, that is where we use data dictionary. But unfortunately, in real life scenario, we don't have data dictionary. Correct? So this is what I wanted to understand. And this is what I wanted to hear. So see, the name or anything, any relation mathematically is not telling me anything. It is useful for me as a data scientist is when it is impacting my target variable. Yes, no?
Right.
Correct?
Yes.
Now, for other models, okay, it is easier. But for classification, again, the question remains. For classification, how do you get to know which variable is important, which variable is not?
Correlation.
Correlation, can you find out with respect to any categorical variable? Target variable is categorical, right? See, I said that your approach is correct, but you are thinking in a way which cannot be done, right? So for example, I'm talking about correlation. What is the minimum criteria of correlation? Both the values should be numeric. Yes or no?
Yes.
What is our target variable in this case? We are talking about whether client will subscribe to a term deposit, right? Let's say, will it take a term deposit or not? That is what our target variable is, whether yes or no. Clear? That is what we are talking, that particular term. Then what will you do? How will you perceive? See, one of the things is, are your splitting criteria? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why you guys are not able to answer this? When we have spent a considerable amount of time in explaining all the splitting criteria that were there to display. Not even a single person out of the class. So what was the purpose of splitting criteria? The purpose was to get one variable, right, which gives you better purity. I always highlighted this. Yes or no? Better purity means?
More homogeneous node.
More homogeneous node, right? So multiple homogeneous node means we are able to classify, better classification. And that is the purpose of our classification model. Why you guys are not able to explain?
Right.
Okay, so now you know, right? That is how you will get to know which particular variable is important. Okay. Coming on to your question, what are P days and previous? Okay. See, P days is number of days that passed by after the client was last contacted. Right. So, let's say. For any last contacted for any term deposit or any such, you know, you get a call, sir, loan le lo, credit card le lo, those things, right? So when was, I mean, what is the number of days? Let's say if it has 30 days or 60 days like that. Okay. If not available, then. -1. Okay. What is previous? Previous tells you, this tells you the days, right? So it tells you the days. This tells you the times, number of times they were contacted previously. So let's say this particular person who is an admin, name is not given. Previously, how many times was it contacted? Okay. So if you say 0, that means it was not contacted. Got my point? Okay. Now let's go ahead. Enough of the data discussion. Okay. So again, what you will do? You will check.
What is campaign? What is campaign here?
So campaign, I think. Okay. So I think in a particular campaign, right? I'm failing to recall exactly. I need to see, right, what is this campaign. But I think it was something related to
times they have approached with some promotion.
Maybe, yes. Some campaign going on. So how many campaign and so related to that number of campaigns, something like that. Okay. So how many times, maybe, yes. I think it was something like how many times this person was included in a campaign, something like that. You understand? So that is what. Okay. Now, see, not all variables are important, but usually client dump you with everything that they have for data science. Not that they know anything about data science, because they don't want to put their mind and tell you what you think you they will just take you. Okay, this is the whole data available with me, just take whatever you feel is important. And the practice we started in linear regression, we did with 3, but what is the practice that we started? One by one we say that we will try to include columns. Not all columns you would need, correct? Yes, no?
Yes.
Now coming on to our pre-processing, so checking null values. Okay, you know how to do. We have discussed a lot. Okay, correlation. Again, correlation. Result. Okay, tell me, by looking at that, what do you think? What do you think are your observation by looking at this correlation matrix? Tell
you. Previous and previous is important.
Are not correlated.
Huh?
Voice is not clearly. Tell me. Name of the variable is given in front of you, right? You have to tell. What do you see and what do you get from this observation?
P days and previous are correlated.
P days and previous are correlated, right? What else? Others, usually we have?
No correlation.
Not so much correlation, right? Okay. So this is how you read, okay? Usually if you color code, right? If you color code the correlation matrix, then it becomes easier for you to spot out like the way it is for now, okay? How will you check outliers? Box plot is one of it, yes.
Box plot.
Right? So histogram, box plot, right? And after that, let's say manually you use any methodology. Sometimes you can do as vague as, you know, dropping anything which is more than 75% time. You understand? And something which is less than 25% time. So from minimum to 25th percentile, we are removing. Sometimes you can do that also. Just, I'm not saying permanently, but you can try. Okay. You can try if your model is overfitting, then you can come back and you can recheck this method. This is how we do in the data science. What are the other methods? Obviously you can use IQR method, Z-score method. Okay. This is also one of the methods. Those things we know, this is very, casual thing that we do, not very statistically recommended, but casually you will see these things. If you have given a data set just for exploration, your first day at work and you are given a data set, you are said that, okay, explore this data set and come up with the result. Then maybe you are not, you don't want to invest time in writing, outlier detection using IQR or using Z-score. You can simply plot, you can simply see the describe from the describe and what is the this thing, and you can go ahead with this filter. Okay, understood?
In place equal to true, what does it do? In place equal to true.
Don't know in place is equal to true, what it does? Your Python is over?
It does in the same variable.
No, wait, he needs to explain this. So your Python is done. Hello?
Yeah, Python is done.
So you should be knowing by now. See, I don't want to be in this mode, but understand this. I am very emotionally connected with you guys. It pains me when these simple things you are not able to understand. Correct? In place is equal to true tells, see, there are two things in which we can do. First of all, what I can do, I can just assign it to a data frame without writing in place. What it will do?
It will make changes to the new data.
Make changes to that particular column if I directly assign to that column. Yes or no? But if I am not assigning anywhere, then what is the other way? I just write in place is equal to true. That means whatever I'm filtering out, it is actually doing in the same column. Understood?
Yes.
Okay. Again, I'm just plotting, but still you can see some outliers, right? Outliers are there. Similarly, you can drop for other columns, age. Similarly, you can do for other columns like day, right? Okay. And then somehow you get to see this type of thing, which is usually outlier free. Okay. In campaign, again, if it is greater than 3, we are dropping. Okay. Usually campaign 1 or 2 are there, right? So we are using the same methodology here. Why I'm using this casual method is because other two methods you already know and we have used it. Yes, no? You don't know the other two methods that you discussed or other three or four methods using the scatter plot and looking at what needs to be removed using IQR, using Z score method.
Yes.
Okay. So in short, that we are doing for multiple columns, this casual thing, right? That another way of doing is you can write that function one time and you can pass your variable to it and then you can get something which is filtered using any of the method that we discussed. Okay. Anyways, after we worked out on the outliers, right? After we worked out on the outliers and we have done the in place is equal to true, right? This is what we have got the data after that. Okay. Then we will start the pre-processing. Okay. What are the different ways? Okay. So in pre-processing, we saw the encoding, correct? We saw the encoding, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So after that, what we are going to do is data pre-processing. In pre-processing, for now, we are talking about encoding. Encoding, where we do encoding usually?
Categorical
variable, right? So we figure out what are the different categorical variables in our data, and then we can simply do one at a time, right? Sorry, once for all, we do all together, right? We write a function preprocessor, right? And then we are just instantiating it, and we are doing for all of the columns which are categorical. So job, marital status, education, default, housing, loan, contact, month, key outcome, deposit. Okay. Clear?
Yes.
Now, this is how my data set looks like. All in the terms of numerical, yes or no? Then it would be easier for us to go ahead with the modeling part. Clear? Till now, is it clear?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what we are doing is X and Y, as I said, while training, I don't want my model to see, right? I don't want my model to see the target variable, right? Then this is what I have done, right? I have dropped my target variable from X, okay? And that I have said is Y. So target variable is deposit, yes, no, okay? Y is my deposit column only, and that is my target variable. Got my point?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Now, splitting of data into train test set, X train, X test, Y train, Y test. We have explained this thing in detail, okay, about how the data split is happening. What is the test size here? 0.2. Then what is the train size?
80%.
0.8 or 80%. Okay, any confusion?
No.
Now we are straightforwardly going for the application applying the decision tree. First of all, we'll start manual, preparation of the tree. So we are starting with a, thing which is used mostly, that is depth. Because once you control the depth, all the things, right, your number of terminal nodes or your complexity, all are controlled. Yes or no?
Yes, yes.
This is like, for example, you are gardening. Then at the time of pruning your tree, what are you thinking at that point of time? Are you counting the leaves that you have to cut? Or you are just trying the length, right? Trying the length and you are cutting the branch. Yes or no?
Yes.
That is easier. That is what we are doing. So we are just assuming the depth. We don't know what is going to be my score. So what I'll do is we'll start from a depth of 2, then we'll go for 3, then we'll go for 4. Usually manually, this is how you will do. There is no other way. Yes, no? Are bolo, yes, no? Any other way you think is possible? Yes, it is possible. You can make a function in which you can pass, okay? You can make a list of the things that you want to try and you can pass one by one. That is also you can do?
Yes.
Okay. But here what I have done is one by one, just for the understanding purpose, gone. So let's say I am just naming it model decision tree 2, okay? Why 2? Because I have used with depth 2. That is the only reason. You can write DT2 or something like that. You name it. Now I have instantiated random state 1. Max depth is, I have specified manually what? 2. Any confusion till here? What is max depth? All of you know?
Yes.
Okay. Now, after that, I have fitted the model. This is my hyperparameter. Remember, I have fitted the model, right? On this particular model that I have instantiated, right? And I have now trained, by the way, this spelling is, you can ignore. See, T-R-A-I-N should be there, right? So here also, so whenever I'm typing fast, so these things happen. Okay, now this is score train, right? So we are scoring the train, we are scoring the test, and we are printing both the score. What is the score we got for training? Around 83%. What is the testing score? 82%. Fair enough. Not overfitting, not so much overfitting. It's not even the overfitting, right? Small difference is fine, right? That is because of the variability. Yes or no?
Yes.
But let's say if we increase the depth more. So what we are going to do is, instead of going for 3, I said, let's go for 4. Okay. You can use 3 also, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like that. Or you can skip in between. Right? That is how you try out. So let's say all the same thing I'm doing with max depth 4. And this is this training and testing score we have got. So just copy paste. Only the max depth is changed, which is to 4. Okay. Now see, the training score has changed. I mean, it has increased, but the testing score has decreased. What does that signify?
Overfitting.
Huh? Overfitting. Right?
Overfitting.
Okay. You understand from our last lecture? All these things we have discussed. Okay. So the ideal situation should be, okay, let us go back to 3 and then just see 3. How is it coming out to be? Okay. And compare it with 2. If it is even 3 is overfitting, then just settle it for 2. Okay. And then just see what happens. Is it clear? That is how we would have done.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. But let us go ahead and see, what if I increase the depth a bit more? See, if I have increased the depth to 6, what is the training score I'm getting? 98%, even more than that. Should not I be happier?
No, overfitting.
No, I should not be happy. Why? Because my testing score is constantly getting reduced.
Yes.
Correct? Then I have to settle for a model with max depth or hyperparameter max depth where I think I'm getting a very good balance between training score and testing score.
Yes.
You are getting my point?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Coming on to 8, okay? Same thing, copy paste, max depth is equal to 8. See, my training score I have achieved to 100% training score. But what about my testing score? Testing score has not improved. Again, this is a case of what?
Overfitting.
Overfitting, okay? Now, what I have understood by doing it manually is, which is the best model?
Depth 2.
But here is a catch. What if I tell you that at depth is equal to 2, your model is underfitted? Then you have not grown the tree properly. That means the number of nodes are less. Correct. And that is the reason you are getting a good training and testing accuracy. But that is also the, that may, might also be the case. I don't know. Right? Then what will you do?
We have not checked depth three.
That is one of the things, right? But let's say the similar kind of thing happens. Usually, see, whenever you are doing hyperparameters, no, small things are not going to matter much, right? Because individually, you are not going to see each and every step, correct? You have to skip something. If you have to, let's say, if you have to train on all the maximum depth from, let's say, 2 to 100, are you going to touch based on each of the values?
No.
Right. So that is how we do. Further, we are going to discuss how usually we separate this thing, but this is the manual way of doing. Okay. Now let's see how to do, right? Let's say I will go with whatever you have said. What you said for now, maximum depth 2 looks good or best out of the lot. Yes or no?
Yes.
But I just put one seed into your mind. So you have to be careful. Not always, you know, minimum depth is going to be good for you. Okay. Clear? Now, once I have decided that, okay, max depth is equal to 2 is the best model or best max depth. Then what I can do is now I'll start with, let's say, C4.5 and which uses entropy as a splitting criteria. This is what we have discussed in the very first class. Yes, no?
Yes.
Now, I am instantiating the model by one hyperparameter as max depth, another hyperparameter called criterion. I'm just telling entropy. I can write Gini also, but here I'm writing entropy. You can use Gini also. Sometimes changing criteria also changes a bit of, your accuracy, improve a bit of your accuracy. Only a very small difference between entropy and Gini, but still it kind of varies because the way is a bit different. Okay. Calculation. After that, I fitted the model. I have predicted, right? I have predicted and then I have scored the model in training and test. Okay. Training and test. So what are the scores that I am getting? Hello. 81% and 79, around 79.5, right? Yes. What do you think? What do you think of this particular model?
Maybe balanced, but not sure. Train and test scores are closely packed, so maybe balanced.
Maybe balanced. Okay. Anyone else? अरे बोलो बोलने का वो थोड़े okay. What is the default splitting criteria? So this is the default. If you see, okay, I have to annotate. What is the score that we got? 83 and 82 with the same depth. And what is the score that we got there? What is the score that we got there? 81 and 79. Is not both different?
Yes, a little different.
Why is it coming different? Because I just said that the default criteria used is Gini. So there you haven't put any criteria. So what is the criteria used there on top? Mm-hmm. And what is the criteria I'm explicitly telling it to use?
Entropy.
Entropy. So that is the reason there is a difference. But that is not so much difference to worry, right? 83 and 82, right? Around, no need to worry about this much, okay? At least at this point of time, I'm saying. Yes, at your, when you're working for a project, and you are finding any particular criteria is giving you a better result, you can go ahead with that, right? So I'm making you understanding of these things, that these things will vary. So do not get surprised. Oh, criteria I have changed and the values has decreased or increased. Okay, got my point?
Yes.
We are going to use another hyperparameter, but before that, let's see the graphical representation of our decision tree. Okay.
Why didn't we use chi-square that splitting criteria here?
So you can use any. Did I say that you cannot use any of the? See, we have used, we have studied all, right? See, in sklearn you have two, Gini and entropy. Okay, selection you can do from Gini and entropy. Why? Because those are considered to be the best splitting criteria, correct? Because it takes care of the probability, right? One is taking care of the log of probability, another one is direct probability, square of the probability, basically. Yes or no? Correct? And that is the reason we have used both, which are there in the part of sklearn. Understood?
Okay.
Let's go ahead and see the graphical representation of the tree before going ahead. Okay. This is how the tree looks like. What I have used is GraphWiz. Okay. So it is possible that when you used, I have seen in one of my, last month I was trying in my office, and this GraphWiz has changed its version. Okay, so due to the version change, this might not, if you will run exactly this code, this will create this will give you some error. Okay, so the better is you go to that documentation of GraphWiz if you want to see. This is not required, but I just wanted to show you. That is the reason I have kept it. But if you are feeling that it is not running, okay, because you're because of the increase in the version, what you can do is you can figure out few of the variables. These things would have changed. Okay, how you pass these things would have changed. So you have to just fix a few things, and that will be a learning for you also. But still, if you are not able to use, okay, reach out to me. Understood what I'm saying? Hello.
Yes. Yes.
Half of the people are sleeping or what? Okay. See, this is what is this node called?
Root node,
right? And then this is the value 117 and 38, right? At the root node. How is it split?
64 and 83.
62 and 93, right? And I think you guys are not able to see properly. So let me just increase. Are you able to see it now?
Yes.
So 62 and 93. How 62 is divided? 34 and 28. 34 of one class, 28 of another class. So obviously, after 60, we know 62 here, right? Now it is divided into 32 and 30. This is divided into 91 and 2 only. Now, if you see here, there is no splitting, further splitting. Why? Because all the values are of the one class only. Another class is zero. Yes or no?
Yes. Only
when our node is impure, then only it will get splitted.
Right. Okay.
Clear? Is it clear?
What is the x6?
That is the criteria. Right, that is the criteria you use to split the node. Yes or no? We used, right, the height greater than 5.5, something like that we used. Yes, no. In our example, did we use when height was given? Correct. When you ask any question, please do respond if I'm talking and answering your question at least, right? If you don't remember, say that I don't remember. Then I'll explain. You remember or not?
X6, X11, right? X6 less than 0.5, X11 less than 170.5.
No, no, this I'm not talking about. I'm talking about when I explained our splitting criteria. What is the height splitting that we use? Average height. So if you remember, we use 5.5, greater than 5.5, less than 5.5, right? How will you split a numerical column? How will you do? You will use a value and then you will split. That is how we can do, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
That is what it is. Okay. This is how the tree looks like. Okay. Before going ahead, let's see the performance metrics, right? What is the performance metrics? You can print the predictions, right? You can print the ROC curve, you can plot the ROC curve based on that, and you can find out the accuracy of your model, right? So performance metrics is not done here, okay? So we have just find out what is the result and what is the accuracy of that. Okay, before I explain this inserting column with prediction, just let me go through what I want to explain. Okay, this is what I, what is this? What is this curve called?
ROC curve.
ROC curve.
Okay, yes, ROC curve. What does it tells you? What is a ROC curve? ROC curve is basically when you plot true positive rate versus false positive rate, right? This is a default line which says your true positive is equal to false positive.
Yes.
Correct? So if I use here, what is going to be my AUC? If I talk about blue line, what is my AUC?
Below the blue line.
Array, what is my AUC?
AUC is 0.5,
right?
Yeah.
Okay. And what is... anything above this obviously is going to be greater than 0.5, yes or no? And in right. This, if my curve is like this towards the false positive rate, it is going to be less than 0.5.
Yes.
So let's say this is my true positive rate graph with respect to false positive rate. Then this AUC is justified, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Because it's more towards two.
You guys forget a lot, I guess. Okay, tell me what is the thumb rule of using a AUC? What AUC is good to have? What is the ideal AUC? See, the ideal AUC is what 100% means one, right? You're talking about 100% true positive without any false positives. Yes, no?
Right, yes, the probability.
Then why you guys are not speaking? I don't understand. Okay. So confusion matrix. Simple way of plotting confusion matrix, or you can plot it like this also, right? The same thing, 29,370. But if you have to plot confusion matrix, you have to write a lot of code. Okay, you can get from Google also. Okay, but if you have done a proper visualization class in the Python, you might be able to write this. Yes or no? Are you able to write these codes on your own using a function? Not even one in the whole class?
Yes, yes. Yes.
Or if you are not able to write,
I plotted confusion matrix. It did not take so much code.
That is what I was going to say. If you are not, if you cannot write like this, why it is written is usually what happens. If you find the code of confusion matrix on Google, that is what I do. Okay, instead of writing that much, then you will see multiple variations of it. You can use anything, but at your level, see, at my level, it is not required. Okay. But at your level, sometimes just to know if you can or not, at some point, anyone can ask, right? So at least a simple code for writing. Otherwise, you can simply, plot like this, okay? Confusion matrix, y-test and prediction, right? So those things. But it is always good to know things. So if you are finding it difficult, do it for once. Use simpler line of code, which I think in my previous notebooks, it was way smaller. Yes or no? In logistic regression, I guess. Correct?
Yeah. I used heat map to like plot confusion matrix.
Yeah. Here, if you see, you can use this code for multi-class classification also. What is a multi-class classification?
It's 1 minus accuracy evaluation matrix.
What is multi-class classification, I said? And what are you saying? Anyone? What is multi-class classification?
One versus all.
That is the method to achieve multi-class classification. What is multi-class classification?
Where we have a lot of classifications, like not only binary, not 0 and 1, but we have multiple divisions.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to talk is, let's say your target variable, right? Your target variable for now is what? Default is 0 or 1. But let's say we are talking about multi-class classification, means there are multiple class, class A, class B. Hey, we have discussed this when I was teaching you one versus all. But none of you remember. That is the problem, right? We have so many gaps in between. I'm not teaching. That day at least utilize to revise. You guys are not doing. Okay, I'll keep on saying till my class ends. After that, I'm not sure who will tell you, and no one actually bothers, right? You understand this. But you guys are not taking me seriously, then it's up to you. And there is no rocket science asked in interview. They will ask these questions and you are not going to. See, half of you might be knowing, but it is in your subconscious mind. You are not revising, you are not able to understand. You understand, but you are not able to explain. So interviewer is not a god. He will understand only what you explain, that you know. If you don't explain, that means you don't know. These things are being asked, and then people come to us and say, okay, I am not selected. It actually pains me. Okay, so coming back. Class A, class B, class C, class D, right? This is what is multi-class classification. So multiple class if you have. How will you plot a confusion matrix? So confusion matrix is nothing but all the labels and predicted labels, actual labels and predicted labels. So earlier we spoke about confusion matrix in a way that we have only true, false, only two labels, right? True means one, false means zero, or otherwise also you can think, right? But only two labels we had. What if we have more than 2, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 also, then how will we do? This is the way you plot, right? So you can have, let's say, A, B, C, D, right? A, B, C, D, right? This particular cell denotes where true label is A and predicted label is also A. What is this denote? Tell me.
Predicted is B, but true level is A.
Right. That is what it means. Now, okay, there is waste of time if I give you the assignment. Rather, I'll explain in the class itself. Okay. Okay. So if someone asks you, what is the micro average, usually they talk about, right? Micro average in the terms, if you have multi-class classification, right? They call about micro average and macro average, right? Now, let's say there are four classes. Class A, we spoke, right? Class A, class B, class C, class D, right? Four classes, right? So each class, let's see if a class A is predicted as B, is that true or false?
False.
If A is predicted as C, is that true or false?
False.
If A is predicted as D, that is also false, right?
Yep.
If A is predicted as A, that is true.
Yes.
Correct. Now, what is the formula of precision?
True positive by prediction.
What is precision?
True.
True positive by false positive is false negative.
Seriously?
True positive by true positive plus false positive means total prediction, positive prediction made by upon the correct prediction by total positive prediction.
Right? This is my precision. Now let's say class A, right? Class B, class C, class D. Right? Let's say, for example, it can be 4, 5, 10 also, right? Now let's say class A has one true positive and one false positive, right? Similarly, class B has 10 true positive and let's say 90 false positive. This has one true, one false positive, sorry. Yes, similarly, one true positive, one false positive, right? Now, usually in the terms of, if someone asks you about class A, you will give this value, right? What is true positive? What is false? What is precision, right? Like that. But you would be able to give this precision for A, precision for B, precision for C, right? It is very easy. But usually they talk about two terms, micro average and macro average, right? I'll explain for one particular metric and you can guess it for, or you can calculate for all others. At least that you can do, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, micro average is nothing but, let's say, what is the micro average? It takes consideration of all the classes. How many classes we have? 4, right? So micro, if I have to calculate, what is my true positive? 1, right? In the first class, what is true positive in my second one? 10. What is in third? 1, and in fourth? 1. What is the total? So 1 plus 1, 2. 90 plus 10 is 100. 2. If I calculate this, that will give me micro average of my precision. Overall precision, yes or no?
Yes.
Because here yes. You will be able to calculate the precision of A only, right? Yes or no? Similarly, if I have to calculate macro average, you know what it happens? What it says? What is the ratio of true positive upon, I mean, what is P of A, right? That is 1 by 1 plus 1, that is 0.5, right? What about this? 10 by 100, that is 0.1. This is 0.5, this is 0.5. Now, if I have to find out the macro average, how will I do? I'll just add up all the precisions, right? 0.5, 0.1, 0.5, and 0.5. upon total, right? That is 4. Whatever it will be, that will be my macro average. So you understood what is the difference between micro average and macro average? Similarly, you can find out F1 also. Recall also?
Yes.
Correct? That is how we perceive the multi-class classification. Okay. Why it came in our discussion is because I was showing that, let's say, if you have multi-class classification, then also you need to plot confusion matrix.
Yes.
Then it would be easier for you to use this code. Okay. Clear?
Right.
Okay. And if the classes, usually it is 4 or less than that, even in multi-class. But if it is more, then you may consider to increase it further, the cells, right? So there need to be, let's say if you have five classes, so 5x5 matrix like that. Okay. Before that, yes, before that, we are going to see the pruning of tree, and but we have left one thing, right? Here we were talking about prediction, which we have already seen, but I was just telling that one of the students in my batch came to me and say, Dhruv, you know, I have one suggestion which I have done. Okay, after I uploaded this, he said, I have done, and I want you to include that, and that will help others, because I think this is the difficulty I was facing, some other people can also face, right? So he suggested me, he came to me and he suggested, and then when I saw, it is very simple, but very effective. Effective means very useful. What is this? This is nothing but whenever you predict something, whenever you predict, so usually that is, if I just plot, if I print the prediction, this is how it looks.
Yes.
But how will you present it to client? Or let's say, for example, if you have to keep up, keep the file, how will you keep it? Obviously, you have to merge it, right? You have to merge it, correct, with the data. Yes or no?
Yeah.
I mean to say yes. Let's say, what will I do if I don't have prediction with the data? If I am reading the rows, okay, this is the person. Okay, what is the prediction, whether he will give or not? I'm interested in knowing that, yes or no? So that prediction column needs to be with the whole data set. You understand that? Follow, yes, no. Okay, let me explain what I mean to say. This is our data set, correct? These are the rows, right? These are the columns, different columns, okay? Now let's say this was my Y, or my target variable, I removed it. Okay, so X is nothing but X1, X2, X3, Xn, right? And Y is one column Y. Clear? Further Y, if I'm not talking about this, okay? I'm talking about Y. So Y was what, divided in two parts, train and test. Similarly, X was also divided, train and test. Yes, no?
Yes.
Now, what I'm saying is, what you did is, based on your training, testing, you have predicted something. Whatever you have predicted is now, let's say, a separate column. Your prediction is a separate column or a separate list of values. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
But for that matter, a vector. Okay? It can be anything. Now, if you keep it away from your data set, it is not making any sense. Yes, you can always calculate your prediction accuracy, recall, but it doesn't look good if you open the file and you are not seeing the prediction, correct? So it is always good to go back and push it to our original data. Very simple thing, but is it required or is it not? Tell me.
Yes, it gives a clearer picture.
Yeah, because that is somehow completes your analysis. Because you started from the data set and you are submitting it back to the data set. This is very simple, but I took, he told me, and then I thought, yes, I should communicate it to you guys. Usually people are not putting this on, even I was not putting, okay? Because our purpose is to make you learn. Okay. Now, anyways, this is not a part of machine learning. This is more of Python, right? That you have a column, how will you insert that? But still, it is useful with respect to machine learning. That is the reason I'm explaining. Is it clear for everyone? Why is it needed?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And then what he has done is, he has he has exported it with prediction, right? And he has shared this code with me. If you want to do any improvement in this, I have exactly used it as it is, so that you know how the thought process would have gone. But I want someone from your class also should come ahead and, if not anything new, at least come up with a better version of this. Dhruv, I can do better than this. That should be healthy competition. You understand? So that is what is needed. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. So all these things you are knowing or not knowing? Replace function, what it does in data frame.
Yes.
Only very few voices. So
yes.
If you don't know, the better way is, if you don't know, it's fine. If you don't know, it's fine. Accept that, but start learning. Right? How do you learn vocabulary? That is how you learn the inbuilt functions from sklearn or pandas or numpy. The more you use it, you will remember it for the whole life. I don't think anyone of you can forget how to import a data set. Yes, no?
Yes.
Because you have imported it at least 5-10 times, knowingly, unknowingly. At least there you are doing, okay? So that is the reason no one asks me in group, I have forgot how to import data set. But if you see, importing a data set actually is a tough task. This looks easy, but sometimes what happens is when you import a data set and you see your date column is in some other format and it has got in some other format, then what you do? You explicitly specify the dates. Yes or no? Format of the date. What I mean to say is, I'm just giving an example of the real, someone of you was asking, right? What was the real difficulty you face? So currently what we are doing, we are importing the CSV. Correct? Now what happens is, let's say date column is there and there are dates like MM, DD, YYYY, right? And then we have imported this MM, somehow it has taken it as DD and then MM and then YYYY. Clear?
Yeah.
And it is out in the open that you are able to see. You need to fix it, right? At the time of importing only you need to do, explicitly do the formatting. Okay, data, wherever your date column is there, you need to format that. How will you do? Have you guys thought of this? No. So Google it. Now you will say that, Dhruv, you should have explained this. See, these things are, I cannot get a data set in which this problem is there. I faced this in my problem, that is the reason I'm explaining it here. There are thousands of such things that will occur, that problem you will face at very simple level. Never did you think at any point that even importing CSV will consume 1 hour of me, okay? Those things. How will you get to know? The more you do the hands-on on your own, right? Clear? So keep a track of all these things. Okay, coming back. So where were we? Okay, so I was talking about inserting the column with prediction. I just wanted to keep it for last so that you guys understand what is needed. Okay. What else? Yes. Let's talk about pruning of the tree. What is pruning?
Cutting the branches.
Process of removing the subnodes, basically.
Right. So we are talking about the pruning. What happens when you prune the tree? So let's say our tree was something like this. Just to show pruning, I have used GraphViz, right, to showcase what the pruning looks like. So let's say you have cut the trees. This is how. What is the depth of the tree? Here?
Three.
Okay. Now see here. See here. The pruning, again I'm saying, pruning can be done in many ways, right? and how you can keep updating. You know, last year 2020 during around lockdown time only, I remember going onto the internet and I was, see, there is no need because I was not working on decision tree at any point of time, at that point of time, right? But I went ahead and saw the documentation, right? In SKLearn, what they have introduced is they're in post pruning, they have introduced CCP alpha, right? CCP alpha is cost complexity pruning. CCP is full form of that is cost complexity pruning. You know what is cost complexity? We have spoke about it, right? What is complexity basically? So complexity is when your tree is very, it is grown full. That means processing power decreases, complexity increases. That complexity I'm talking about. Yes or no?
Yes.
So it has introduced CCP alpha, right? CCP alpha, which takes care of the sum of square residual, SSR, we studied this. So all those things. And then it has, it actually plots total impurity of the node, right? So let's say, what is the total impurity? So at each point, there is some impurity associated.
Yes.
At least, right? So once it goes, down from top, right? I'm talking from the root node to my leaf node. Obviously, what is decreasing? Impurity is decreasing.
Impurity decreases.
Right? Now, total impurity, if we see of the leaf nodes, effective alpha tells us about how to, if my alpha is increasing, obviously complexity is increasing because we are associating a term alpha with respect to complexity.
Yes.
Yes or no? So let's see if I plot it with respect to total impurity of the leaf, then I can get a value which is kind of optimum. Tell me yes, no.
Yes, yes.
Right? And that is what we will use as effective alpha. If you use I am giving this as an assignment, which is just for the higher reading and for the people who are interested in going ahead, read this CCP underscore alpha. If I am not wrong, this is the function CCP underscore alpha, and it is used in post pruning. Right? Post pruning means you grow the tree full. And then you see what is how much is my complexity, how much I want to reduce, right? So you will just plot the curve at an optimum level where you think that my total impurity should also not be very less and my complexity should also increase. See, you understand, your impurity will go 100% when you reach up to a certain level. I told, right? If you grow the tree full, it will, even if that node contains only one node, right? That means it is 100% pure. Bolo na.
Yes.
Right? That means it is 100% pure. So purity is 100% almost, right? In one node, it is there. So all the leaf nodes, if we see, the purity is attaining very good. But what is also increasing with respect to that? Complexity. That means your max depth is increasing, your leaf nodes numbers are increasing, your branches are increasing. Yes, no?
Yes.
Correct? So that is what we have to keep a track. Then what will you do? That you will plot complexity, and on the other hand, what you will do? Impurity. So obviously, I don't want impurity to be 100%. I don't want it to be zero also, right? Why? Because if I'm going for zero, obviously my effective alpha is increasing, correct? So I'll reach one optimum level, and then that is up to you how much you want to go ahead with. And then I'll use it as a hyperparameter to prune my tree. So let's see, if I said that this is the complexity I need, my tree will understand, okay, I don't have to grow after this. Why? Because it is increasing the complexity. Understood? Understood?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So read about it. So yes. So I was giving this as a homework. So CCP alpha, right? Read about it, because we all know what is pruning, what are the impurities, right? What is some square residual? So all these things combined, you will get to understand what is CCP alpha and how is it used. Coming back. So pruning of the tree. How will you prune a tree? I can prune a tree based on any threshold I can put. For example, I said while I was explaining the pruning that I can set my tree constraint. Yes or no? Correct? I can set a threshold. And whenever I set a threshold, if it is exceeding that, so if it is exceeding that, let's see, if it is not equal to that, it will unlink itself. No further split. Yes or no? Are bolo na? Yes, that is what we have learned, right?
Right.
So you can write a simple function also in which for a particular tree value, if it is less than threshold, then it will
terminate.
It will keep those nodes.
Yes, and if it is not and if it is not leaf node, that means we are talking in the terms of terminal nodes, then it will unlink, right? Unlink it. So unlinking is done, and that is what the pruning is. Okay, you got my point. So after the unlinking or pruning has been done, this is how my final tree looks like. Correct? Why? Because we have done a pruning in which we have taken consideration of my tree length. Correct? I don't want it to grow full, and that is why we have done the pruning. So I'm fine with it. If this particular node has this much entropy, this and this. Clear?
Yes.
Understood, everyone? Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay, again, I'm repeating, this graph viz may give error. Okay. And that is the reason I haven't run it full, because I did not have time to, fix these variables. So all the things are very simple, right? You understand? Only these, see, figure size, right? Instantiating, string IO, right? After that, we are exporting the graph viz with which I am plotting this, and I am passing the variables. These things, just keep a check on this based on the new, it will give you some version error, that something like that. And if you go into the detail, it will also help you understand this. So please work on it. And that is also kind of, you can take it as an assignment. But if you're, again, I'm repeating, but if you are not able to do it, please reach out to me. First of all, discuss among yourself in the group. If you guys are not able to do, then reach out to me. Okay. I'll then go to the documentation. I did not get time. I'll go to the documentation, and then again, we'll be talking about this. How to fix. Can I expect that?
Yes.
Yes.
More voices, please. Correct?
Yes, yes.
Now you can also see what is the use of this. You can also export in PDF or PNG. That is the use case of this, right? And also one thing, not only GraphViz, there might be in last like around 1 year, there might be another libraries also, which would be giving you a better, visualization. You can use that also, and you can educate that to me also, and other your colleagues also. That is how you gain expertise. Got my point?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Any confusion till here?
No.
Anyone? Okay. Let us go to random forest then. Okay. What is a random forest?
Multiple decision tree,
right?
Right.
Multiple decision tree means we are growing the tree sampling with replacement. with replacement. Always remember this, right? The only way in which without replacement is done is one case wherever you have this hyperparameter called bootstrap. If you make it false, then they do sampling, but without replacement. Okay, that is only case. Otherwise, usually random forest is used with bootstrap aggregation, right? And bootstrap is true by default, okay? But in any case, if you want to set it false, then only it does without replacement. Otherwise, it does with replacement. That is the only difference between decision tree and random forest is, correct? So random forest, nothing but combination of different trees. How that tree is selected is what is can be taught in random forest, except that everything goes in the terms of decision tree. So half of the thing that even we are going to see in random forest can be useful for decision tree also. Okay. And that is the reason I have saved few things like grid search CV for here. Okay. If you have guessed, here we haven't used grid search CV, which we are going to use here. Clear? Again, all the required libraries. Okay. And here the data set we have, we are going to see the cancer, you know, breast cancer prediction. Okay. And this you can use in your CV also, or any project for that matter, if you are understanding what is the problem, right? First of all, what is the problem, right? And no need to write that you did it on cancer. Same thing will go if you do it for COVID. Same thing will happen if you will do for tuberculosis, right? Same thing can go if you do it for HIV. Yes or no?
Yes.
As a data scientist, how much I am knowing what does this thing mean? Radius, right? So basically this is the cancer cells, you know, those radius. But it is not useful for us. We are not, if you tell me, Dhruv, tell me more about it, I won't be able to tell because I'm not a doctor, right? Or a pathologist, right? So by that I mean that you can use the similar data set to explain in the interview. And how can you be different? Even after using this particular data set in your and doing this particular project, you can say that I have done it for any disease in this world. Can you say yes or no?
Yeah.
Correct. Only thing is the variables will change. Okay. So you can think of the variable which will be there in that particular data set. The whole thing will be same. Yes or no? Okay. Coming on. This is how my data set looks like. Now, if you see M and B, right? M and B is basically tells there are two types of cancer, malignant and benign. Okay. And we are actually trying to see what is the type of cancer, what type of cancer it is. Is it benign and malignant? Okay. So this is basically breast cancer, prediction. Now, if you see there is ID, again, diagnosis, which is my target variable. See, we have a perception that target variable will always be at the last or rightmost. How many of you have this perception in the mind? I usually had that when I started, okay? So I never used to imagine that, target variable can be anywhere, right? At starting also, in between also, you have to define target variable. Anyways, so because as a practice, we write X1, X2, X3, Xn, and then Y, correct? So we always write Y in the rightmost. Yes or no? So I had that in mind. Okay, so this is the diagnosis, which are target variable. Other columns are nothing but the data set which tells and which will help us to classify any breast cancer into these two parts, whether it is M or B. I'll be telling M or B, or we will map it to 1 and 0. Is it clear till now?
Yes.
If you see, it is mostly taken the statistics of the radius, right? Radius mean. texture, you know, what was the texture? So the encoded texture mean, right? Perimeter mean, area mean, smoothness mean, compactness mean, right? So that is how it is given. So they have measured several cancer cells, right? And they have find out the mean, and then they have put for this particular diagnosis, right? Let's say this is the, this is the person for which we are seeing. And these are the values. Again, this is an example in which you can say that we need a domain expertise. Yes or no?
Yeah.
Yes.
Correct? For any, let's say if we are trying to remove any column. Otherwise, if you're using all the columns, then obviously you need not to do, right? But let's say if there are so many columns that you need to understand which are the most important columns, then obviously you would be needing any domain experts. And that is the reason we have domain experts in our data science project. We call it SMEs or domain experts. Okay? Clear? Till here, is it clear?
Yes.
There are two indexes. So what we have done is, there is no use of this. So we have set the ID as our index. Okay? That is how set index function you can do. And after that, what we have done is diagnosis. I know there are only two types, benign and malignant. So I have mapped it from M to 1 and B to 0. You can do anything otherwise also. I have just mapped it to 1 and 0. And after that, this is how my data set looks like. Clear? But here I can see that there is a column which is mostly NN, right? So let's say I am seeing what is the null values. So all the columns are fine except this column unnamed 32, which has 569 null values. What I'll do, I'll simply drop it because I know this is not something, not required. Okay, so I'll do. And after that, this is how the data set looks like.
Dhruv, one question for that diagnostic. Can we do on hot coding or that type for putting this one or zero?
But there is only two, why will you do one hot encoding?
That is not categorical data, right? That one.
That you can do, but it is not required. You can simply map one. See, I'll tell you, if any column has only two values and you know it, no need to go for one hot encoding or label encoding.
Okay, yeah.
What you can do? You can simply drop it to 1 and 0. Why will you drop it, man? That is a target variable.
Yeah, mapping it to 1 and 0.
Okay. So you got what I said?
Yes. Thanks.
Okay, cool. So this is how it looks like now, our data. Okay. We'll see the dimensions, right? And let's say data types. Okay, so everything is in float 64. So float is there, 64-bit float. Okay, now let's describe the data. This is the description of the data. You all know about it. Count, mean, standard deviation, minimum, 25 percentile, 50, 75 percentile, and maximum. Clear? So this tells us about all of the columns. Clear? So let's say if we have 1,000 column, how will it show? So if you do the describe on 1000 columns, so it will show some columns. After that, it will show dot, 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 and some last columns. Okay. So for any particular column, if you want to see, then you have to describe it explicitly. Okay. Any confusion till here? No pre-processing we have done here because we will concentrate mostly on the, every time I am not going to do pre-processing, right? Pre-processing is something as an art, like, for example, I'm not going to explain how to import the data every time, right? And with that, let me announce it. So as I said, and I forgot to recall you guys, yesterday was not possible. So we will have a class on Monday, that is day after tomorrow. I think 2 hours class. We'll be doing EDA, pre-processing EDA, and one case study, right? One case study on regression, right? So 2 hours we'll try to do. If it is not possible in 2 hours, we'll extend a bit. So maybe 7 to 9, I'll ask Apurva to schedule. Okay. That is for the people who are, you know, not able to do. I'm not sure what is the problem, but that is to help them, right? But I usually avoid that in my previous batches. This is the first time I'm taking those classes explicitly, you know, doing it. I mean, hands-on, or you can not the hands-on, but hand-holding that is needed. But it's fine. I have to go with whatever you guys say. So I'm going ahead, but I'm not liking it. That I know the people who have requested for it, they themselves have not tried. I know that because every class I'm giving assignment and I'm not getting any responses from at least those who wanted everything to be cooked and presented in front of them, unfortunately. But yes, I'll do as, you know, as I think is good for you. After that, it is your call, okay? If you don't want to do, it's your call, okay? Clear? So yes, we will
be... So, Dhruv, pre-processing an EDA is not mandatory, right? For to do?
Not mandatory to do? Who said that? Obviously, you need to do pre-processing. It's like saying that if you have missing value in the data and it is not mandatory to do, obviously, we'll do. What is pre-processing? Pre-processing is getting your data ready for the modeling, right? So missing value treatments, outlier removal. So explicitly, we have seen all those things. Now you know all the functions, all the details, how to work on that. Only you have to import the data, that also you know. Pandas function you have to apply, filter you have to apply, that is also taught in Pandas, right? SKLearn is there to help you out. I have explicitly taken one class in which I have explained all the end-to-end process. What is the problem there then? Import the data and get hold of it. Discuss among your peers first. Yesterday I saw one question. I tried to reply. So whenever I'll find time, I'll reply. But I'm not finding that in your group. But it's okay. Let's not discuss that. Whatever. Okay. So we will be doing this hands-on. So you guys can join on Monday. Okay. For the people who want to see me doing. Okay, instead of them doing, so they can join on Monday, 7 to 9. Okay, let's not discuss on that point. Coming back, so split data set into train and test. Okay, multiple ways we can do this. One way is I showed you in this. I try to give you multiple variation of the same thing. This is one of such case. So you can use log iLog function. How many of you know log iLog?
Implicit and explicit indexing data.
So indexed location or explicit, explicit location, right? Wherever you specify the column name, right? Here I'm specifying the index of the column, right?
Yes.
So that is the reason I'm calling it iLog. I should not be explaining this because this is what you have already done these things in Python, okay? So if I write this, which is not wherever this column is not present, that means I'm talking about all the column except this, right? So all those columns except the target variable are nothing but my features, right? Okay. And the column, diagnosis column, is nothing but my class variable or my target variable, correct? So that I have done. Again, train test split, okay. And here, what does Revel does? Anyone? What does Revel function does in Python? So basically what happens is usually you have two dimensional arrays, right? What are arrays? You know, right? What is dimensions of array? That also you know. So let's say if I have a two-dimensional array, right? And I have to flatten it. So Revel is used for that. Understood? Okay. So read about it if you are not knowing that. That is pure Python. Okay. Got my point? It is used to flatten. Flatten, you know?
I think we had a function of flatten as well.
So you can think it in that way only. Okay.
Yeah.
Clear? Or you can use think it as you are converting it into an array, flattened array. Okay. Clear? Now we are instantiating the random forest classifier, and I am not putting anything but just putting the random state. That also I have explained why we put random state, just to reproduce the result. If you use 40, the splitting will happen in the same way. Okay. Now, here what I'll do is I'll use directly grid search CV instead of going for the individual parameter tuning. Okay. So what I'll do is, what I'll do is here I have put start and end just to let you know how much time it took. Okay, just to record the time. So do not worry about why I have written that. You can comment that out also. Okay. What I have done is I have put a list of parameter that I want to try. So let's say max depth, I want to try 2 also, 3 also, 4 also, 5 also. Bootstrap, I want to try as true or false. That is the only two things. Max features, how many features consider at the time at the starting, right? I spoke about it. So auto, square root, log 2, none. Okay, so if you see none, it won't take any value from you. It will by default take, right? Similarly, that goes for auto, right? Criterion, Gini, entropy. I want to try it both and give me the better result, whichever it gives. Clear? I can pass other hyperparameters also, but it will take more time. You got my point? Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay. Now what I'll do is I instantiate the grid search CV, right? Okay. And then I'll pass the random forest instantiated, wherever I have instantiated the random forest, because I'm applying the grid search CV on random forest. That is the reason I put cross-validation, how many folds of cross-validation I want, I have put. You know what is cross-validation, right? And what is the fold of it? Clear?
Yes.
Right. Now, param grid is where you pass the parameter list. So what is the param grid? I have named it param dist. So param distribution I have passed. Any confusion till here? And n jobs is equal to 3. That is telling that how many processor I want it to be running at a particular time is maximum is 3, correct? Not beyond that. That means take as much time as you can, but only use up till 3 processor, right? Or 3 jobs you can see, 3 threads basically at one time, parallel threads. Got my point? Any confusion till here? Yes, no. This is very important. You will be using this.
So you are using 10 fold, right?
Sorry?
10 fold.
10 fold, yes. 10 fold cross validation I'm using. Okay.
What is it? N jobs 3. Could you please come again?
So I'm saying that number of parallel threads, right? Number of parallel processing, right? That is allowed. I have allowed it to be 3. I don't want it to use all the cores of my processor. I have explained this also in the time I was explaining the hyperparameters, if you remember. Abhi bologe nahi yaar. That means remember, just admit that you don't remember. Okay. If you remember, if I set it to -1, what does that mean? Anyone? If I set
n jobs to all the cores.
-1.
All the cores of the processor.
All cores. Basically all cores. Right? And n jobs to 1 means one core
one,
of my
one core.
2 means 2 cores of my processor. 3 means 3 cores of my processor. Right?
Yes.
Correct? So that means I don't want my, let's see if this is not heavy, right? That is the reason, even if I don't put, I just wanted to show this because I taught you. But even if I don't specify, it is not going to affect much. But let's assume that the parameter distribution is huge. You have used 5 or 6 more hyperparameters, right? Terminal nodes, all those things you have used. And after that, even if you have increased the options for it, so maximum depth, you have increased the options. Max features, you have increased. Let's say criterion only two, you have other things. Let's say terminal nodes and all those, you have multiple options. You are increasing the option, right? Then what will happen? It needs, you know, more, because there are multiple parallel processing that needs to happen, right? So it will use, it will eat as much core as it can, right? So if you have not specified or specified -1, what it will do? It will use your all cores. Then other tasks which might be going on your local system would be slow. Yes or no?
Yes.
Also, if you are doing it on cloud, let's say if you have specified as -1, it will use all the cores. And since there is a cost associated with it, you have to be very careful. Understood?
Yes.
You got this? What njobs is?
Yes.
Okay. After that, what I'm doing, after I'm fitting, right? I'm fitting on training set, class set, right? Fitting, I'm passing those values. And after that, I am simply printing the best parameters. And this is the magic, right? This is the magic. So in between, it is taking some time, considerable amount of time. And after that, we are going to calculate the time also manually, but how to get the best params, you see, it gives you the best params, and you have to just get it from cv_rf, which is your trained name of grid search cv dot best_params_. That is how you get the best param list, and it will give you the list, right? So what is the list? Bootstrap is equal to true. So out of these two, bootstrap has to be true. Okay, criterion is entropy, right? Max depth is 4, right? Maximum features is auto. This is the combination of the 4 hyperparameters that we have tuned. This is the best. So if I grow a tree, or sorry, if I train my random forest on only these 4 criteria, that means now I can explicitly say that max depth is equal to 4, bootstrap is equal to true, max features is equal to auto, and criterion is equal to entropy, without worrying about what if others has given a better result. It cannot. At least from the list which you have passed, this is the best one in the lot. You got my point?
Yes.
I will repeat if you are not understanding. Tell me. At any point, if you are not finding it useful, it's fine. See, repeating at the time I'm teaching, I can repeat 3-4 times, right? But you guys don't revise and then come to and then forget everything. Then I cannot repeat everything that I have taught in the past. You understand? And that is the reason I told you, live in present. Yes or no? This is what I have said. Tell me, any confusion till here? Let me clear it and then see and tell me. Any confusion in this grid search CV?
No.
No.
Okay. One thing, I spoke about bootstrap. What does bootstrap is equal to false mean? Only the time when
sampling without
replacement. So this is a sign I make for with, and this is the sign I make for without. So without replacement, okay? So without replacement. That is the reason bootstrap is equal to false. But that is the thing that is given to you by sklearn in order to understand if it is giving me a better result, right? Then I can use that. But random forest as a definition is bootstrap aggregation. So bootstrap has to be true most of the time, all right? If it is false, that means it is without replacement and number of trees may be less, okay? Understood? Till here, is it clear? Important features, I mean, important hyperparameter is tuned. Tuned means you have got the value for which those will provide a better result. Okay, clear? Can we now go ahead, right? Can we now go ahead and C. Let's say we are fitting. Without this, we have got this best, you know, best feature as this, but I'm just going ahead with something else. Let's say I'm going ahead with criterion entropy, but max depth, max features log 2, right? Here it has came as auto, max depth 5, right? This is what I'll say. But if I use the one suggested by grid search CV, that is going to be the best one. Yes, no?
Yes.
But then also, why I have used others is, then also it is to show you, then also you can try out by yourself as a human being, right? And then you can pass it in the term of what is the set params that you want to set it, right? Clear? Is it clear? Or you can set these parameters which grid search CV has given you, which is better, obviously grid search CV, but just for tryout, you can use any other parameters also. Till here, is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if you remember, we spoke about OOB rate, out of bag error, correct? Out of bag error, clear? So what I've done is very simple code, right? Very simple code. We have started with minimum estimator, right? Until maximum estimator. Let's say this is, I'm saying that number of tree, I'm starting from 15 and I'm going till 1000. You can grow it till 10,000 also, right? You are understanding this? This is what I'm saying. So that is the reason I have set it there, right? so that it can be changed later. Now I have initiated error rate, okay, as empty. And after that, I have written a function. I'm starting from the minimum estimator, going till maximum, estimator, and then, right? And then I am just fitting the model and, right? And I am saying that, see, OOB score is actually opposite of OOB error, correct? OOB score, you can think it as an accuracy, right? So if I have to calculate OOB error, that is nothing but 1 minus OOB score. Tell me yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, now you can use anything. You can use OOB score also, but what should be the choosing criteria then? Better the OOB score, better is the model, right? Or higher the error, that model is not good, right? So if you're using OOB score, you have to be careful, okay? Clear? Is it clear? That is how. Now, if what I'll do is similarly, so I have started from 15 and went till 1000, that is the error I am plotting here, okay? So error I'm plotting here. So obviously I have to consider wherever it is minimum, yes or no?
Yes.
But you understand, again, I'm repeating. So we have to keep a track of the complexity also. I cannot grow a tree of 10,000 unit, okay? Yes, I know it is a random forest, but I cannot grow a tree of 1000 tree, correct? What is there in then for us? I have to keep a limit, okay? So what I'll do is, based on your understanding, you can think of it as selecting the best possible option. What do you think is the best possible option here? Some people will say, in my last class, some people said that 400 is a good number, right? 400 is a good number, right? Some people said that whatever it is 650 is a good number, correct? Understood? So it is up to you what you call. But if you see, there is a sharp curve, gives me an image that might be some overfitting or something. Just for one moment, the error has decreased, and then further it increased. Yes or no? So I don't want to use at that point of time, but yes, you can use anything because I think for a longer period, it remained stable. So you can use this many trees or whatever it has. So I keep it open for you, how much, at what particular number of an estimator or tree you want to use the OOB error rate, or you want to take the OOB error rate as minimum. Clear? And why I'm not using 400? Because of the same reason. I can see only for a limited time, it remained less. And after that, again, it increased. So that means it is giving me that it might be overfitting. Okay. Kind of stability I'm looking for. Okay. So I am seeing that, let's say I'm taking 600. You can take, let's say this value also, whatever comes here. Okay. Clear? You understand what I'm saying? So it is not that Dhruv has used 600, then that is the reason. You got the concept. Concept is more important. So anyone using this value, 550 is also fine. Anyone using 600 is also fine, right? Anyone using 650 or whatever the value at here, those guys are also fine. Okay. Clear? You got this, what I'm saying?
Could you please come again this part?
Okay. So let's talk about this. From very scratch, okay? Let's say I'm talking about any error, right? And this is how the error is fluctuating. I'm just making a similar kind of, you know, graph. Let's say this is the error, right? And after, okay, now wait. Just want to show it. Now let's say I'm saying that it is coming like this, it is going down, again it is coming up, it is like this, it is like this, it is like this, and like this. Okay. Now if you see, right, if you see here, so there can be multiple levels. Why I have drawn two is because for maximum trees, the OB error rate is in between these two. So this is manually drawn dotted line. No need to worry about that. That is something special. No, just concentrate on the red graph. Okay. So what I'm saying is I have to keep a track of the complexity. How will you select? This is number of trees. And this is my error. Okay. So if I go at very, you know, very minimum, where, so one way is I can choose wherever my error is minimum. So I can choose, let's say, and stable. Obviously, error is minimum, it's stable. So you will say that, Dhruv, that is maximum, minimum, and stable I am achieving after 900. Correct? Or let's say 880, something like that, 850, right? 850 NST meters if I choose, or number of trees, that is giving me minimum error and better stability. Yes or no?
Yeah.
But what is the drawback of choosing 850? Too many trees, correct? So complexity has increased.
Okay.
So I don't, yeah. I have to get a trade-off that yes, the error should not be too much. Obviously I need the error also less, but not at the cost of complexity. I mean, I want to say that even I'm fine with this much extra error, if that is coming with the, with increase of 250 more trees, I will rather not use this many trees than I'll use this error, this much more error. You understand?
Yes.
Okay? So there is always trade-off. That is the reason I'm saying that it is subjective. Correct? Sometimes you are fine with the complexity, but you want the error to be reduced. Then obviously we'll take 850. Correct? Otherwise, what is the minimum error? So before this line, around you can say this line. Around this is 0.033, around that you can say. And after that, it has further decreased, but for a very less level. And this level has already, you know, achieved here at this particular point, whatever it was, around 650, I say. Okay, so you can take this, or if you think that your model is still going complex as per your computational power, you can still, you can use 200 also. Provided with this many trees, your model is not underfitting. How will you see the underfitting? We have explained this in detail, bias, variance, trade-off. Yes or no? Clear? Any confusion now?
No.
Okay. So let's say someone has used 650. The only difference, that is also correct. The only difference is this error will be something else. Let's say 0.033, right? You can use that. Someone can use 850 also. Obviously the error will further decrease, or let's say it is still 0.32, only a small decrease. Okay. Now you have to see how much cost effective you have to make, or if you have free, you are free to use on cloud, then you can use anything. You can even increase the number of estimator. How? You can just change the value. So it is, so we have used the maximum iteration as 1000. You can turn 10,000. Just see it has further decreased or what. Clear? So there is no set. I always tell you, it is you who should decide, because you are data scientist. Okay. So you can anyways change this maximum estimators as 1000 to 10,000 like that. And then you can see what is the error it is coming. Again, I'm repeating that instead of using a OB error, you can directly use OB score and the perception will reverse, right? Here it will be minimum, and further wherever the error is minimum, that will be maximum. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Clear? Now, manually I saw that 600, or in your case, let's say 650, in some other cases, let's say 850 is the best n estimator. You got my point? So now I have n estimator 850, 600, bootstrap true, warm start. Okay, what is this? What is this warm start? So basically it is there to reuse the previous solutions, that is there, right? So whatever you have, I mean, it is giving your model the power to reuse whatever it think would have, would have worked best. Okay. So let's see, if I'm saying warm start, can add a new decision tree, right? Add a new decision tree with the help of previously trained decision tree in this particular aspect. Okay. So warm start is false. If I am setting, then memory, it is not using the memory in that particular sense. It is not using, this is not a very good hyperparameter to tune. So leave it as it is. I have kept it in open just to know you that there can be multiple hyperparameter that can be used. Okay. Understood? OB score, I'm doing, let's say false. I don't want OB score now. Why? Because I have already seen what is the error rate and I have got my n estimator for it. Any confusion? Hello. Anyone has any confusion till here?
No, Dhruv.
Okay. Now, even if I have put this much, you can see there are multiple default parameters also, right? Multiple default parameters. You can get it from the parameter list of Sklearn. But this, whatever I'm explaining, even at production level, you will be mostly working out with these things. Clear? Okay. N jobs, we have already explained. Min sample split, min sample leaf, right? There are multiple other things like min impurity split. Read about it. It is in line with the same hyperparameter tuning or setting the constraint. Clear? Okay. Now we will train the model. We'll train the random forest now with more number of hyperparameter. Why? We have added an estimator, right? So one by one, this is how we do. Okay. Clear? We will train the model. We will predict it. And then we will find out the prediction results. Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay. There is one very important thing to consider, that random forest can give you the variable importance, right? Or importance of any variable, and it can rank all the variable with respect to its importance, right? I was discussing just now at when I started, right? How can it done? How can it be done? With the help of what? Splitting criteria? entropy or something like that? Yes or no?
Yes.
So you can write a function, right? Variable importance. This is not a function. This is just we are returning. From where we are taking? We are taking from feature underscore importance. It is basically, it is coming from sklearn, right? So this is sklearn's own feature importance, and it uses entropy to calculate that. This variable will only try, right? Only this is just a function to see if it has already fitted or not fitted. If not fitted, then it will return that model does not appear to be trained. So that you are not looking at untrained model. Only it can give when you have trained. Why? Because we are using on fit, right? Clear? Understood?
Yes.
Now, how will it give? We know how will it give, but how will it look like when it gives, right? So for that to look like, okay, we have to write, we can show it in multiple ways. How can I show the importance if I have to show? Tell me, you know visualization of now, in which plot can give me if I want this type of plot? If I have to compare 50 things, which chart I can use, or what is that I can use?
Bar chart.
Bar chart, right? This should be now at the tip of your tongue. Anyways, coming back. So for that, what we are writing is, it will just take take the mean decrease in impurity, right, and then it will just print, okay, with respect to wherever mean decrease in impurity of this, mean decrease in impurity of this, right, mean decrease in impurity of this. If you see, very less mean decrease in impurity means very high impurity, right? That means the rank is 30. So the first rank is area worst, is basically a very good variable, right? Parameter was is second best, third best, fourth best, fifth best, like that. So it has ranked the variable. And as you said, how will we do? So we have done one function to just plot it as it is. So this is what the area was is the best feature, right? Parameter was area was is the best feature. After that, parameter, after concave point, all those things. Clear? So we have kind of plotted, which gives me important variable. Now you know how it is giving important variable, okay? And let's say if someone asks you, what are the 5 most important variable? Can you give it from here?
Right.
Yes.
And you know internally also, how is it finding out? Important variable for a classification is nothing but a variable which actually splits the data into more pure subnodes, right? That is the central idea from where we have started, explaining the things. Yes or no? So that is the central idea behind giving this important variable. No rocket science. Okay, we have gone in very much depth of it. Okay, after that, again, the predictions, right? This is what the predictions looks like, okay, for our data set. After that, you will just plot the confusion matrix. This is how the confusion matrix looks like. Okay, black means these are misclassification, right? Misclassification. These two are correctly classified. Okay, those things. Accuracy, right? Same thing. Fit RF dot score, and then you can find out, okay, accuracy, error rate, right? 1 minus accuracy also you can do. And another way is you can directly use the misclassification. If you remember in logistic regression, we showed you. Yes or no? Correct?
Yes.
Similarly, here also you can do what? AUC. So this much of the thing. Okay. See, this is kind of my production code in which we have to write the proper commenting, right? Proper commenting. I am just kind of showing you the way, right? So this is the ROC curve, and AUC is 0.984, which is very, very, very good, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Maximum is one, and it is kind of swepting around 100% area. Correct? Classification report. This is what the classification report looks like. That means, if you remember, we had two types of cancer, benign and malignant. What is the precision for this particular class? What is recall for this? What is F1 score? Support is nothing but the number of points which is correctly classified as benign. Okay, so if I go here, so 71, right? 71 plus 2, 73, right? Out of 73, it is able to get 71. So if I have to see the support, it is 73, and this is nothing but 41, right? And that would be visible here. So 73 and 41, correct? Total points basically. Now you know what is micro average, what is macro average, and weighted average, you know, when we consider the weight of it, okay? So usually they ask micro and macro, difference between them. I have already explained that.
Yes.
Micro and macro. Sometimes you will, you will get confused between which one is what. So just devise a method to remember this. Okay, I think, let me just paste it there in the has formed the layer. It is not going next. Okay. You should be able to get it. Okay. So just properly put it in your own note. Okay. My handwriting, because I was explaining it. I'm not sure why it has come like this. Okay, so pardon me for my handwriting. What was this? I will explain something else so we can delete this. Okay, so I'm just saving it. Okay, going back to the method. Okay, now this is what you would be able to get from the class. This is called classification report. So report means sometimes you are taking care of precision. That means for your data set or for your problem, precision is more important. For someone else, recall is more important. For someone else, F1 score is more important for any problem, right? For that matter. So that is what we do. And support is there. Tell us what is the total number of points there. Clear? Okay. And if you see micro average, since we are considering all both the classes, so that is the reason in support you see summation of these two. Clear? And that is what we are precisely doing, micro and macro, even in weighted. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And then let's say what you will do. You'll predict on the complete data set. So complete data set means you will predict on the test training, and then you will insert basically the prediction that you have done. Okay. Clear. And again, see, earlier, if you remember, what we did, we actually replaced the value from, let's say, 0 and 1. But when I'm repeating or when I'm sending it to client, let's say, just for the sake that we are showing that this is how our model performed in the training and testing, then obviously you cannot say 1 and 0. You have to again convert it back. So keep that thing also in mind. Is it clear?
Yes.
Any confusion? See, I know it is in very detail, very basic things that I have tried to cover, but this was to explain you properly how the things work in the real case scenario. Okay. Understood? Otherwise, for the people who are not interested in programming, for them, I showed you something called what, pie caret. Yes, I did it in class. Your yes. class only, right?
Yes, you did.
If
yes.
you're not finding it useful, you can simply use that. Okay. Let's say your purpose is not to become, not to do the modeling or something like that. You just want to explore the things for now. And later part, you just understand it for now, and or else you don't have time, right? You have only 1 hour. Obviously, you cannot do each and everything. And till the time you would be able to do whole things, the things would end, right? So for them, they can always go to PyCaret. You will get a tutorial notebook from GitHub. You can use it. It is just 5 or 6 lines of code, and then everything is you are able to do. Even the hyperparameter tuning, it is doing without even telling you what it is doing. Okay. And just revise the theory, you know what it is, correct? But at some point you have to do, right? So sooner or later you will have to do. So better pick it fast. If you have less time, then only I said. And then only that is one of the things that you can do. Clear? Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay. Now, in evening, what I'll do is I'll upload a capstone project now. Correct? And I'll give 10 days for it, which is more. You will say it is less, but I'll say it is more. Okay. And I just want to explain what I need in that. Okay. As a submission, okay. So capstone. So I'll be giving data set plus problem statement. Correct? All the things that you have to do, let's say if it is regression or classification, right? Only these two would be there. Clustering. We'll see. Okay. Now if it is a problem, then obviously what you will do? Do all the pre-processing, EDA, modeling, and then result you will get to know. Okay. Based on the results, you will prepare a PPT. I am making you ready for the real life world. Okay. That is the reason you will make only 2 or 3, slides of PPT in which you will publish your result. I mean, write your result and then try to explain the result. Okay, try to explain the results that I got the accuracy of this much. This is my training accuracy. This is what that does that mean. And then I went ahead with this. So that is what is required. Okay, clear. And I may ask you to explain your PPT or your project. Requirement is clear. What I need as a submission.
Yes.
No internal discussion with respect to capstone will happen on the WhatsApp group. Please don't ask questions. Discuss about the concepts, not about the questions. Specifically, I'm telling for capstone. Please don't do that. Okay. And this is what I am going to expect in the form of PPT. So what you will submit, your Jupyter notebook and your PPT. I'll be looking at the PPT. And then your Jupyter notebook. Clear? So consider me as your client. Okay. So I'm just giving you the data set and problem statement, and you will come up with the PPT because I don't know anything about data science as a client. Okay. So you will explain those things in plain English. Obviously, you will use the term, but after that, in plain English, also you have to explain what does that mean. Okay. And obviously, your Jupyter notebook. In order to verify that yes, you have achieved that, clear. I won't want anyone to ask anyone else, I'm getting this error, can you help me? No help in capstone, please. Get first-hand experience, get used to the problems that you are facing. Yes, if you are thinking that you are lacking somewhere, then on Monday class, we'll be working again on a pre-processing EDA mostly, and we'll do the modeling also on regression. That will clear some doubts of you. Any confusion till now? Then after this, today I'm uploading by evening.
Okay, Dhruv, one question not related to this. So whatever data set we use today, we can use the same for linear regression and other regression also, right? Means there is no such constant. It is, might be a silly question, but just asking you.
No, that is very silly question. You understand? Because
this is a
silly question, I don't care. But what question you asked, you tell me. What is difference between a regression and a classification?
Yeah.
What is difference? Tell me. Tell me what is the difference.
Yeah, regression. See, means we have some target variable.
Here so also we have target variable.
So based on the, that means whatever the independent, there are some independent and dependent variable. So we are
dependent and independent.
Yeah, sorry.
Here also we have dependent and independent variables.
Yeah.
See, you understand this? Always classification and regression is different because there what you are doing, there your target variable is what? Continuous. Here what you are doing?
Binary.
Your first of all, your target variable is
categorical,
not discrete. This is categorical, right? 0, 1, you can think it as a discrete, but that is a kind of a categorical, right? Yes, no.
Yes.
Malign, yes. Benignant in our case, right? So can you use this in regression? The answer is no. If you have the same target variable and same problem, the answer is no. The answer is yes if you change the problem and you change the target variable. Let's say now I just want to predict the income of anyone, correct? Then my target variable now, let's say it is whether he will take the deposit or not, will be one of the variables and income will be my target variable. Then I can use regression, yes or no? So if you are asking with the same data, yes, I can use, but the thing is, I have to change the target variable. That should not be categorical. In regression, we need to have the category variable as continuous. Does that clear your confusion?
Thanks.
Revise, properly revise. See, I don't want to scold you guys. I feel very disappointed when even after spending so much time, I'm not getting very simple. See, I'm not asking very difficult questions in class, right? I'm asking very simple things.
Yeah, Dhruv, I found many data set in Kaggle. So when I start using the data set, so I just wonder what to proceed, like should I use linear regression or decision tree?
Use everything. There is a term called in data science called no free lunch. You can Google it. I'm not making this up from my side. Okay, if you don't believe me, so. See this? What it says, no single machine learning algorithm is universally the best performing algorithm for all problems. That means you have to try multiple models. And this is not me. This is even in Wikipedia. You understand? That means if someone, magician comes to you and say, hey, this is the problem in which random forest will, see, you can only guess that yes, this model can work best, but the original result may vary. So answer to your question is use all that you know. Okay. Got my point?
Okay, yes, sure.
So no need to worry about that particular thing. How will it happen? Use whatever you know and then compare. That is what we do in real life scenario also. Okay. So we saw regression, classification, though we are going to see multiple other classification models also. But before that, let us touch base to the third kind of, you can say, models, that we have in machine learning, that is nothing but clustering. Clustering is more of a unsupervised learning. Why clustering is unsupervised? So usually, how does a clustering works? And that is what we are going to see that in today's class. Okay, so let's start with the clustering. Okay, we'll cover till where we can today. Okay, we'll try not to extend, at least not for half an hour. Okay, let's talk about it. So first of all, clustering, I'm just giving very basic or bookish type of things first, and then we will go conceptually into what these things are. So clustering is nothing but grouping. So as always, we are considering the name. So what is the name? So even before, let's say, studying data science or machine learning, you might have used this word, right? And this is for what you might have used. Yes, no? Hello.
Yes.
Correct? Now you understand this. And another way is we have said that it is unsupervised. Correct? So grouping, okay, we have said that this is unsupervised and is used for grouping, right? Then what is the purpose? So purpose is to have a similar group. So find similar group. Similar type of groups, okay, or similar type of object in a single group, right? Now, what is the definition then? Let me write the definition. It is nothing but, clustering is nothing but collection of object or person or anything, right? I'm just writing it object, which are perceived to be similar. This word is important. Perceived to be similar between them, right? And dissimilar, that is the opposite of similar, right? Dissimilar, pardon me if my spelling is not correct. Dissimilar to the object belonging to different clusters. What do I mean by this particular sentence? So I'm saying that clustering of objects which are perceived to be similar, right? Which are perceived to be similar. We are coming to that, but before that, to be similar between them. So I'm saying the object which are similar to them will form a single cluster, right? Object, again, with the same definition, object which are similar to them will form a single cluster, right? So it is similar to all the members of its own cluster and is not similar to all the members of any other cluster. You got my point, what I'm saying?
Yes.
Correct? Now that is what we have written, right? Now, what is that perception that we are talking about? How do we percept anything to be similar? For example, how do you find your friends? Usually, a group is formed, right, by similar type of interest. Yes or no? If I'm a backbencher, my friend will also be a backbencher mostly, right?
Yes.
If I'm going to, let's say, I play basketball, usually I'll make my friend who also plays basketball, right? Yes, no?
Yes.
Except arranged marriage, obviously, that I don't know. Okay. So coming back. So what I mean to say is, for example, we are talking about clustering. So in a way, all the items or all the objects that belongs to one cluster are perceived to be similar?
Yes.
Yes.
So on the other hand, if we have sample space is nothing but a scatter plot, you can think of it, where I have all the objects randomly put, okay, or all the, let's say, persons, right, randomly put. And then what I have to do is I have to make a cluster out of the things that are similar. Do I need to label it anything? Is there any label to this? No, you said you saw that these things look similar. That is the reason. Let us name it cluster A or cluster one or cluster whatever you want to say, right? Clear? So based on my understanding, I can make multiple clusters. But only thing to consider here is all the objects that belongs to one cluster should be similar in any way. Got my point?
Yes.
Okay. I'll take a very simple example. Let's say if I own a Levi's store, for example, right? Now, if I have to do campaigning, right? If I have to do campaigning, what will I do? I'll see my data set, right? Which will have, customer name, occupation, frequency of visit, salary, spend data, date of last visit, number of dates since last visited, something like that. So, but I don't have any column which actually tells me about this thing. What is the cluster or which cluster it belongs? Right? This data I don't have. Why? Because this is customer data. Now it is me who will form clusters. So based on my understanding, I can form two clusters out of this data, or I can form three clusters out of this data, or I can form five clusters out of the same data. Yes, no?
Yes.
Correct? Again, my criteria can be, what I can do is, okay, I can divide my data set into two clusters. One having, people visiting mostly during sales, and people who are visiting mostly during fresh arrivals, something like that, so that while rolling out the offer, I understand that all the people who belong to this particular category will mostly come when we have sales. So there is no point in sending the messages when I have the fresh arrival to these guys. On the other hand, these guys don't like end of stock sale because they are interested in the fresh stocks. Okay, so I should not send them the notification when there is sale or end of the season sale. Yes or no?
Yes.
Correct. On the other hand, I can say that I'll have one people who always prefers to buy at sales, one people who doesn't buy at sale, who always take the fresh arrival. There are one cluster I can also make, which is a combination of both. Correct?
Right.
This is also correct. This is also correct. I can make five clusters. So that is one of the criteria. You can set your own criteria on which, let's say on the income range, I am making five clusters. One cluster which is having zero to, let's say, 15,000 per month, and 15,000 to, let's say, 30,000 per month, then 31,000 to whatever, like 50,000 per month, and 50,000 to 1 lakh, then 1 lakh to 2 lakh, 2 lakh to 5 lakh, 5 lakh to 8 lakh, 8 lakh to per month, right? Like that. So based on that, I can make different clusters. That means all the people belonging to that cluster will have the same. That means if I have said that this cluster, whatever I name it, is ranging, the salary is ranging from what? Anything from 0 to 1,80,000 per year, right? Then obviously what will happen? All the people who are earning less than 15,000 or around 15,000 a month will be coming in this cluster. Anything above that will go to this, subsequently to this. Clear?
Yes.
Did anyone tell me that which cluster should this customer belong?
No.
It is me who decided, right? What is the number of clusters, right? How right. to decide, right? So this is my criteria. So that is the reason it is called unsupervised learning, right? If you remember in classification, what was happening? So the data actually was labeled. That means a person was either belonging to, I'm talking about the training data, right? So a person was actually belonging to a class, class of malignant or benign, right? Will term deposit or not? Yes or no? But that is not the case here. Correct? Bolo haan ya na?
Yes.
If you have understood. Okay. Cool. Let's move ahead. Now, when I talk about clustering, okay, right, there are two types of it, and we are going to see both. One is called hierarchical clustering. Right, and this time I think my spelling is correct. Okay, now in hierarchical we study dendrogram. This is also a dendrogram, right? Dendrogram based clustering. What is dendrogram? We are going to see later. Okay, non-hierarchical we are going to see k-means, right? There can be k-medians also, but we are going to see k-means. Okay, clear? What are the use cases? One of the use cases we just discussed. Another use case can be, let's say you install any app, right? Let's say Google app you install, right? Google. Okay, at the starting when you install, they ask you your interests. Yes, no. Tell me. Yes, no. So I'm talking about use cases, right? So the first one is, I'm talking about, let's say, Google. So let's say news. So what they just ask you, if you have interest in politics, sports, something like that. So based on your interest, they will send you the notification, news notification. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm not interested in, let's say, for example, if I'm not interested in politics, it won't send me politics. If I'm interested in politics, then it will send. Then what Google does is, usually if you have selected news, that means you belong to a cluster or belong to a people who has subscribed to the news. Okay, now all those people, right, will be in that cluster, and they shoot notification for all those people. Now some, based on the interest, let's say some people have put on Indian politics, right? That is one tag. Now based on that, it will push notification for all the people who are interested in Indian politics. Clear? Similarly, let's say I belong to a particular state of India. So I'll subscribe to the news of that particular state. Subscribe means I have put that as my interest. Even if I don't put, based on my user, let's say if I am searching too much of that particular city, now automatically Google knows that, okay, this is the city it is interested in or related to this. Okay. So kind of I will be similar to someone who is searching or is living in that city. Correct? So it will automatically push me the news. Correct, you got? This is how it uses Google. Another use case can be movie recommendation, right? Movie recommendation. I spoke about it in our very introduction class, right? Machine learning introduction. Can someone recall?
Netflix recommendation.
Yeah. Based on my interest, they will put me into certain category. Let's say if I like certain kind of, if I like drama, or some people like horror, some people like comedy, some people like action, right? Based on those things, or based on the actors, actress, right? Based on that, they can form the cluster. How many cluster they have formed, I don't know, right? How many cluster they have to form, they also don't know, right? That means it can go scale up, right? Tomorrow a new actor will come, a new singer will come. They'll have to increase one more cluster, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Correct. So based on that, they're pushing notifications to us. That means we are into their clusters, and all the people who are getting that notification are. So yes, I was talking about the use cases. So you understand what it is. Okay. Now I'm talking about a live use case. Let's say how the things work, right? Let's take an example. Let's assume that we have to launch a product. What we have to do? We have to launch a product. You are a product manager in a product based company, and we have to launch a product. Product doesn't always mean a manufactured product. It means can be a service also. That is also called a product. Yes or no?
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
So what we have to do is we have to launch a product, and hence we have to define a goal to make three marketing strategy. How many marketing strategy? Three marketing strategies, right? And the data available with me is, let's say I have the age, engagement, right? Engagement in let's say days per week. If this is the data set available, very minimal. So age of the, you know, age of the person and engagement in day per weeks, right? How many days they have engaged to my product, for example, right? So how the data looks like? So let's say age 42, engagement is seven days a week, all the days they have engaged, right? Age 18 and engagement is 3, 23, 2, 49, 1, 37, let's say 7, right? 51, 1, 46, and 20, right? So that means this is on top, you have the age, and on bottom, you have the engagement in days per week. Okay? So these are the two people who have engaged most. Yes or no? So let's kind of draw, right? I have to take a reference. So let's draw this on Cartesian or on XY axis. Okay. On Y axis, I'm just putting the engagement. And on X axis, I'm putting the age, right? So what are the data points that we have got, right? So let's say if engagement times per week, so obviously I'll put seven. Okay, let's start from zero. So this is zero and this is seven. So here is something around three. Here will be something around two. Here will be one, three, then four, then five, then six, right? Six. Okay. And the age, right? So age, so what is the maximum age we have here? 49, correct? 51.
51.
So 51, let's put here, scale up. So around here, it will be 25, 26. Okay. And so we will kind of give a approximate, okay. So let us now label the data point. Where will this first point lie? Tell me, 42 and seven. So 42 would be something around here and seven, right? So this is the data point. So let me write it 42, 7, right? Correct? What is my another data point? It says 18 and 3, right? So 18 will be around here, right? And 3 here, right? So 18, 3. Similarly, I'm just contemplating, right? Kind of approximating the things here, right? So 20 and 4, right? So 20 with 4. 20 with 4. What else? I think 23 with 2. This will also come around here, right? So 23. So these are kind of similar, right?
Yes.
I have to tell this at this point of time, okay? So I said this, okay, 40 and 6, okay, 37 and 7, right? This is what we have here. Rest, now there are people with 49 and only with one engagement, 51 with one engagement, okay? Now, what do you think? How many clusters are here? Considering you have to make a cluster of similar kind of people. So how many kinds of people you think are here in our in this particular problem?
Three.
So this is one. This is three. And how is, so these two guys are similar to their each other, right? That is the reason they are in the same cluster. Similar, these people are kind of similar to each other. These people are kind of similar to each other. Yes or no?
Yes.
Correct. And that is the reason we have created three. See, this number can be four also, but we will see how to decide on optimum number of clusters. And that is one of the most important question they ask. But for now, you understand. So let's see, if I have to launch a product and three marketing strategies I have to launch, I'll launch a strategy to engage these kind of people and these kind of. Yes or no? Because that is what my target audience is as per the data set. बोलो
यस
अंडरस्टूड दिस थिंग
राइट
ओके Now, in the starting, I said that please read about Cambridge Analytica case. So that case, I just explained it in bit brief. So that point, that is also case of clustering only, right? If you remember, I explained this Cambridge Analytica case.
Yes.
So that is also the case of clustering. Okay. Now coming back, what is the question here? That was just the use case. Okay. We haven't done enough. Then you have the question. How does the clustering happen, right? How does it happen, right? How does the clustering happen? Let us see, right? Let us see with the help of a very good example and perceive it as a story, right? Perceive it as a story, just the way we took the third use case, perceive it as a similar story, but always remember that this story you have to remember throughout whenever you are going to use so that you are able to understand what we are going to talk. Okay. So let's say how does the clustering happen, right? How does the computer look? See, as a person, we saw that these people are similar, but how does the computer look at the points in the term of distance? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
These three are kind of nearer to each other and far yeah. from the, that is the reason it will form a one cluster, right? So to yes. understand much depth, that is in one line, but to understand this in much depth, let me tell you guys one story, okay? One story, and then that will clear the doubts for you as in how the clustering happened, that particularly for K-means, right? Let's say that we are a food truck company. You know what food truck is?
Yes.
You know what a
yes.
food truck is?
Yes.
And now let's say these are my customers, right? These are my customers, right? Here. Wait, I'll tell you something. And some persons are. Now I'm going to explain you K-means, how K-means work in the terms of clustering, right? So this is how I'm a company, right? I'm a company. So let's assume that this is my city, whole city, right? Whole city. And what I have to do, now you understand this. So what I'm saying is, for example, if I'm a food truck company, and what we have to do is we have to serve our customers in a city, and these are our customers, right? Now this is how my customers are located. I know that. Okay, now what I did is I will locate, because I'm a food truck company, so obviously I'll send the trucks. This example why I have taken is very important, you have to understand. So what I will do randomly, I don't know what is the best possible place where my food truck should be, right? For the customers also and for our serving also. So I don't know. So what I'll do is I'll randomly put food trucks at three places. Let's say one food truck I put here, another food truck, let's say I put here, right? And let's say third food truck I put here. Any confusion? Let me name it 1, 2, and 3. Any confusion till here?
No.
Clear? Now, step by step I'm going. So what is the first step I did? Locate three random food truck around the city. Yes or no? That is what I have done. I haven't done any research. Where should it serve? Where should I keep the food truck so that it is easier for all the customers, right? You understand? So I have just put as it is, anywhere. Okay, randomly. You can put all the three at same place, but that is bit very, you know, stupidity. That is the reason I'm not doing showing it here, but that also can be done. That also can be your first step. Because I said randomly we will put. So random can be anywhere, correct? What is the step two? Step two is before going ahead, there are some logics that we have to put in place or that we have to apply. There are some logics. So let me put it so that when you are revising, you are able to understand. There are some logics which when applied will make the decision better, right? And it is very simple. So first thing I'm telling is everyone is going to their closest food truck, reasonable restriction, right? Yes or no? Anything extra out of this world I have asked? No. It is obvious that if you have three food trucks all serving the same food, or let's say, for example, if I have an outlet, food truck outlet, so I'll go to the nearest one, right? If I have to eat that, unless someone else is making better. But in this case, these food trucks are from the same company and considering the taste is same. Clear? So all the customer will go to the nearest food truck, yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. What is now the second concept I'm putting, the best location to serve is always what? Center point? Of location? Any location, yes or no? Center point of location is not meaning that you are exactly going at the area wise. No. Center point of the people. How many people are located and in center of that? So in center of the distribution, right? Center point of the location. And hence our truck, right? Truck will move to the center point. Center point of where we have to distribute. Yes or no? Tell me.
Yes.
Correct. Now understand, there is one more. See, we have to repeat, right? We have to repeat step A and step B, right? Right? Subsequently, till it is stable. Stable means now, the truck is not moving any further, right? Significantly not moving, right? You understand? So what I'm saying is, let's see, if the truck is moving, obviously the distance will also change.
Yes.
The truck is moving to the best location. So the distance of a particular customer will change. For example, what I'm saying is, if the truck one moves and comes to, let's say, this place, and truck two moves and comes to this place, obviously the distance changed, yes or no? Hence the priority will also change. Now this customer won't go here, this customer rather will go to truck two, yes or no?
Right.
Correct. Understood. This is the only restriction I'm making, that everyone has to go to the nearest food truck. Clear? Now after every iteration, what is happening? So let me show you the iterations. Currently, let me tell you this, let me do one thing. Let me color the truck and its respective customer so that you are able to understand which customer is going to which particular truck. So let's say if it is yellow, obviously all of this is going to this food truck. Right? I'm assuming, right? I don't know. But I'm assuming that, let's say, these people are taking from this foot. Okay, any confusion?
No.
Okay. And these people, right? These people plus, you know, let's say these people are taking from food truck 2. Okay. And these people, right, are taking from food truck 3 because for these customers, food truck 3 is the nearest. Any confusion? Bolo, any confusion?
No.
Okay. Now what happens is, now what will happen is, now food truck 1 will think, randomly I have put, this is my step 1. Now in the second iteration, the food truck will think, okay, the food truck will think that the customer that I am serving mostly lives to the left of where I am or on the top of where I am. So what it will do, just give one second, it is rotating. Okay. So what it will do, so what it will do now, this will, okay, what I said, the truck has to move to the center point. So is one at the center point of its customer? Hello?
Yes.
No, it's not. More customers are on top than on right, right? So obviously it has to move a little bit in this direction, so that it is equidistant from all the customers. Yes or no?
Right, right.
Similarly, the 2 has to move a bit left, and similarly 3 to has to come somewhere around here so that it can serve equally to all the customers. Yes or no?
Yes.
So that is what we are trying to do. Now with the same thing, now assume that the truck has achieved make the truck, where will I make? Okay, let's say the truck has now moved to here. Okay, the first truck. The second truck, which was serving this, now is moved to this place, right? And now the third truck has moved to this place. Okay, for example, now how does the thing looks like? Let us see that. Now this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. Clear? So all these are obviously purchasing from food truck one, I will name it later. Okay. But what about this, which were earlier purchasing from 1? Will it still purchase from 1?
No.
No, because after first food truck moved to serve its customer better to the center point side, now, and this food truck 2 moved to the left. Okay, pahiya chhod diya. Okay. Now, after that, this food truck 2 is better to go for these, right? So it all will go, right? Similarly for the third cluster, all the people will go to this, right?
Yes.
Clear? Again, in next iteration, what will happen? It is still not in the middle. This is still not in the middle, and let's say this has come in the middle, for example. So in next iteration, it will try to shift in the middle. Though each point will represent the same cluster, that means if I take this individual point, it is still taking from the first cluster, right? Or first truck, right? But still, my this truck will move or not? It has to move. Why? Because it has always to be in the center of its target customer. Correct? Understood?
Correct.
So now it has moved. After that, earlier, if you see, if I tell you that if you have to cluster among the customers who takes from the same, food truck, then what would have been our approximate cluster? This was our first cluster in a way. This was our second cluster, right? And this was our third cluster, not including the food truck. Obviously, food truck is nothing, only data points. Okay. So this was our third cluster. Yes or no? But after several iteration, what is actually happening? This is our one cluster. This is our another cluster. And this is our third cluster. What do you think? Which case is better?
Three.
This or that? This case, right?
Yes, sir.
This iteration. That means now, obviously, if this was taking from first, that is only because my first was here. Now, consider this, right? Consider this to be the mean, right? Right? The mean of all the data points. Now, mean will always lie in the middle, right? Since currently it was serving to these also, that is the reason it was here. Now, if the more number of customers were here, that is the reason it was moving towards the more number of customers, right? And once it tried to move, saying that it is just trying to reduce the distance of these customers left. Why? Because two also came, you know, near to this, correct? So after each iteration, it will settle down to one place. Yes or no? And that is from where we will get our cluster. Got my point? So the trucks you see is nothing but your mean. What is that? Your mean. That means it is moving towards the center point. Understood?
Yes.
Right? And this you will remember. So what we are moving, right? So we are moving, we are kind of shifting the means, correct? Yes or no? Center, my truck was movable, right? So earlier, if I randomly put in between, the mean was considering the point which was taking from here also, right? Which was affected because of this also. But once it moved towards there, this point is left. Then it is only because of these points that the mean we will calculate.
Yes.
You understand? So that is the reason you can perceive this truck as the mean, and it is constantly moving till the time it settled down. And all the means are moving, correct? Then, if you remember, we took a decision. So let's take an example. Okay, I think let me remove this first. Because we finished in two iterations. So if you can draw it, you can take it to multiple iteration, but the concept is same, right? You understand? So if you remember, and let me write, we took a decision. What was the decision? Which was taken by you and not by the model. There, this pen started to. What decision I took? Number of trucks. Yes or no? That I decided. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Pen is becoming slower. Right? That we decided, not my model, right? Because I said, consider that we are sending out three, trucks. Correct? Then your question would be, how would we get to know what should be the number of cluster? And that comes, there comes the most important question, which is asked from clustering. This question is asked most number of times, and every time if you are writing clustering, right, they will ask this question to you. Imprint it in your mind, and then we are going to see, oh, we are already 20 minutes due. Okay, we will finish this question and then we'll break. Okay, so what we are saying is, what is the question? Question is, how do you know, or how do we know, right? Yeah. How do we know how many clusters? Or another way of asking the same question is, how did you decide the number of clusters that you have to take? Correct? Now, the in one word, if you have to give, you have to give that elbow method. Answer is using elbow method. It is also called WSS or within sum of square method. I'll be coming to that. What is this? Let me explain it in bit detail. Okay. Usually you won't find, this explanation properly. Okay. You will get confused when you go to internet and get to see. Okay. Let me explain it properly. What does it mean? Let's say if I have one cluster, right? One cluster means I want to do one grouping only, right? And this is how my cluster clients were, right? And if I want to do one cluster only, right? This is how my data set would look like, all belonging to the same cluster. What if I have the two clusters? Let's say this is belonging to one cluster and other two, and I am just just to differentiate, I have made with another sign. So this is one cluster and these two are belong to different clusters. So 1 + 1, 2 clusters, right? Let's say with the same data point, right? With the same data point, if I have 3 clusters, right? So this is how, so this is one cluster again, and this is the third cluster, right? You are understanding what I'm saying? So this is one cluster, this is two cluster, this is 3 cluster. That means here all the data points are considered as one group. Here all the data points are divided into 2 groups. Here 3 groups. Subsequently, you can go on and on. For example, here, now I am dividing the same data points into how many? 4 groups. Okay, so how will you divide? So it is tough, but I'll try. Okay, so let's say this is one group and this is another group. Okay, somehow. Okay, and rest here, whatever was the fourth group, right? So what is this? Is 4 cluster. Subsequently, it can go on and on, right? What is the crux of the matter, right? As a human, right? As if I ask you by showing this, where do you think the better clustering has happened?
Fourth.
I think, right? 3. Right? So this is kind of similar, right? This is also similar. This is also similar, but no need to divide it in 2, right? So I think this is one cluster, this should be one cluster, this should be one cluster, right? Why this is not a good? Because this is far different from here, but these two are same clusters. So this is not a good thing. Obviously, one cluster is not at all feasible, right? So 3 and 4, if it in between 3 and 4, I think if it is all at the bottom, it should be all belonging to the same class and not 2 class, right? In this question, right? So by looking at that, we have just that, okay, 3 cluster is best. But what does the machine think? How does the machine think? Okay, let me quickly change the perspective. That is how we thought about our clusters, number of clusters. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, let us see how the machine is thinking. So machine is thinking within cluster sum of square. So what is within cluster sum of square? Distance between the farthest point of a cluster. So it is one cluster. What is the distance between farthest point? First of all, figure out the farthest 2 points. So this A and let's say this B are the farthest, right? So let's say this is the distance I'm talking about, correct? So this is the farthest 2 points within this cluster. Yes or no? Any confusion? Bola na? Yes, no?
No confusion.
Okay. What is the farthest point within of any cluster within this setup? I think this is the farthest point. Yes or no? What about 3 clusters? I think this is the distance. Okay, what about 4 clusters? Farthest point. I think this is the one. or this is the one, yes or no? Now if I plot the distance versus the diameters or number of clusters, right, how will it look like? So the distance I can just tell as diameter or distance, right, or WSS, right? Now let's say if I had one cluster, this line was, this is, let's say, one cluster, this is two, this is three, this is four, this is five, this is six, subsequently, okay? So if you see, that distance is maximum when we have one cluster. What about two? In two, it is bit less. Yes or no? This is more or this is more? Obviously, this is more. Are you understanding or any problem in understanding? You can ask.
No, we are understanding.
Okay. So let's say I'm talking about the distance of this. This is more, right? And right. For two clusters, since we are considering only these two are one clusters, right? Then farthest point would obviously be less than earlier because it was taking overall as one cluster. So that thing has changed. What about three? It has further decreased. So now it is this. What about in the fourth cluster? It is same, right? If you see, it is same as three, around same, right? Because this has changed. These two has not changed, right? So if you have taken the distance, which was maximum in this or here, it will be around about same. In our example, it is totally same, but even for other examples also, it was around about same. Further, it will decrease, right? And if you just plot a graph, let me use any other color, how will the graph look like? It will come like this and go like this. So you see, at k is equal to 3, let's say k is nothing but number of clusters. At k is equal to 3, there is one elbow made, the way your elbow looks, correct? Yes, no, tell me.
Yes.
And that is the reason we will take k as 3, wherever our elbow is made. That means, what does it mean in real life? So I'll take a point after which, even if the diameter or distance between the cluster is decreasing, but it is not significantly decreasing, correct? Right? It will decrease, obviously. After some point, it will further decrease. But this is where we have to take the elbow, right? Because we have a trade-off. We cannot build, let's say if I have 10 data points, I cannot build 10 clusters. All the data points belonging to one cluster with the same concept as classification, right? Overfitting, right? You understand? That is the reason we have to keep a track, and that is the reason we take the elbow. This is where our elbow exists, and this is the optimum number of cluster. And that is the reason k is equal to 3 is optimum. You understand? So if nothing is given about a problem about our use case, then we'll take k is equal to 3. For example, how will you override this k is equal to 3? Sometimes someone comes to you and say, hey, you have to build 4 cluster. So that is predefined that you have to build 4 cluster. Then instead, even if it is a bit more complex, right, then also you'll go for that number of clusters if your client says. Is it clear? Till here, is it clear?
Yes.
Okay, read about it. That's all for today.